Phelan summary. So there's lots of points, but I guess the big points are there's some history following us that there are a lot of negative results. The negative results are consistent with nuclear physics, condensed matter physics. In order for Fleischmann-Pons excess heat result to be real, there has to be a major problem with condensed matter physics and with nuclear physics. In a sense, that's the biggest message that should have been taken away from yesterday. There are many, many positive results, and that's motivating us to try to be more interested and be more serious about things and begin to study the experiment, try to understand what's going on inside of it. We had our first baby steps in that direction. We were interested in phase diagram chemical potential. And what we learned yesterday as our first step towards understanding the system better is that when you put hydrogen or deuterium into palladium, it stretches out the lattice. The more you put in, the more stretching goes on. So you kind of expect that it gets harder and harder to push more in. Now the elastic stretching is part of the energy required to keep putting it in. There's also an electronic part, which I didn't mention, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on. But that's an even larger effect. Let's go on.
Peter, may I just ask one question? And something yesterday you're saying this loading is harder beyond 0.8, and you increase the pressure. So does that mean that successful experiments are loaded with a lot of pressure?
No. What it means is that if you were trying to accomplish the high loading using gas pressure, the amount of gas pressure you would need would be prodigious. You have to work very hard to put it in. Now, electrochemically, you can create a sort of an effective gas pressure by turning up the voltage, and that's capable of loading. We're actually going to be talking about that shortly.
Okay.
I'm very interested in that problem, and it seems like you're interested in the problem too, so it seems to me to be worthwhile to try to understand it. Okay, deuterium diffusion in palladium deuterite. You can look in the textbooks, where I consider Fukai's metal hydrogen systems book to be an example of a textbook, and you can get a formula for the diffusion diffusion constant, and it looks something like this: 5.5 times 10 to the minus 7 centimeters per second, 1 minus x. X is the loading. Basically, it means if you've got loading and you're trying to go to another site, if it's already occupied, you can't go there, so that reduces the diffusion. You might look at this and say, well, it's just a number. I can't tell whether this is big or small. Well, this is big. This is a very fast diffusion coefficient, and hydrogen deuterium diffuses in palladium very rapidly. Let's think about this. At low loading, the diffusion coefficient is this number. The length, the characteristic length that you can diffuse is the diffusion constant times the time, take the square root of it. So if I plug in numbers, I get seconds, I get centimeters. Fleischmann's cathodes, in some cases, were a millimeter in diameter, 3 millimeters in diameter. So here's 1 millimeter. If I want to diffuse 1 millimeter, it's going to take a few times 10 to the fourth seconds, an hour's 3,600 seconds. And so in less than a day, you can diffuse into a cathode that's a millimeter-sized cathode. Fleischmann-Pons experiments, also SRI, the experiments go much longer than that. So you think, well, if the hydrogen's diffused in, how come it takes a longer time? So that's one of the issues that we'll be interested in. We'll talk about that today. There's another minor issue in that if I look at Fukai's textbook and I draw my line, and I look in the literature, there's this very famous hydrogen and metals guy, Baranowski. Baranowski went to the trouble to measure hydrogen diffusion in palladium at high loading, I guess in this case, deuterium. And the curve is here. So the question is textbooks here, curves there, should we ask for our money back on the textbook? No, you don't get your money back on textbooks if it happens not to agree with the experiment. So the question is what's going on? So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm interested in making up a model for diffusion. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take Baranowski's data. So here's Baranowski's data points. I plotted them up as a diffusion coefficient, and I made a line that fits through it, so it looks very pretty. So now I have a model for what's going on at high loading. The diffusion coefficients, this is, if you like, in this region, it's even bigger than it was before. So hydrogen, deuterium still diffuse very well. There's some experimental data by some Italians, Mengele, who's a very, very good guy. So this is the, what he did is he took a piece of palladium, heated it up, and flowed deuterium through and was watching the flow rate through and from that getting the diffusion coefficient. So here's the values. Probably you can't see this. This is H to PD loading. Here's 0, here's 0.6. So this is the miscibility gap region. At high loading, the numbers are very big. Here's 10 to the minus 6. We were hoping for numbers times 10 to the minus 5, but they're big there. Here they're very small. This is 10 to the minus 9th. And we scratch our head and we say, well, you know, Fukai's textbook, diffusion coefficient, these numbers seem to be different by lots of orders of magnitude. Why? What the heck is going on? So I misspelled, it's Ansager, not Ansager. But Ansager had this idea about diffusion. And his idea had to do with potentials. So if you have a gravitational potential, the force is the gradient of the gravitational potential and things fall. So he was thinking, well, if you have a chemical potential, can you get an equivalent force from a chemical potential? I mean, can I think of potentials as potential? So if I have a chemical potential, I have a gradient of chemical potentials, that can give me a force. And if it does, can I think of diffusion as being driven by a force being proportional to the gradient of the chemical potential, sort of by analogy with the gravitational force. So let's think about that for a moment. The chemical potential, we were arguing the other day, in the miscibility gap is flat. So if I have a region that has no loading, or 2% loading, and 50% loading, 60% loading, and I have a gradient, if the chemical potential is flat, Ansager happens to be right, I should get a very low value for the diffusion coefficient. On the other hand, if I have a region that's 0.6, another region that's 0.8, another region that's loaded to 1, there's a big difference in the chemical potential, and if the chemical potential is giving rise to a force, then here I ought to have a very high diffusion coefficient. And the experiments, the experimental results, in the miscibility gap, the diffusion coefficient's really low. That seems to be consistent with this kind of picture. So we can, if we want to describe things with a normal diffusion coefficient, we would get a diffusion equation, something like that. If we replace the model in terms of density and normal diffusion with the Ansager point of view, and gradient of the chemical potential, we get a slightly different model, which can also, if you believe that the chemical potential, at least in some region, has something to do with the density, then you can go back and forth between the two and get an effective diffusion coefficient from the Ansager picture. So here's the effective diffusion coefficient that might result from such a model. So in this region, we fitted Baranowski's data. Turns out there's some fine print Fukai's book about the diffusion constants good in the alpha phase. So here's the alpha phase up to percent or two. Here's the beta phase, and miscibility gap has mixed alpha phase and beta phase. So what I've done here is I've just taken a line and nailed it down to a small value. Mengele's data was down further than this value. The reason I chose this value is in the literature there was some NMR measurement that happened to be consistent with this number, with a loading somewhere in between here. I have no reason to believe that this is going to be constant in this region, other than that the chemical potential ideally is flat. In reality, it has some minor variations as well observed experimentally. Now, if you have a hole in your diffusion constant, then suppose you start to load. You're loading your cathode, deuterium's going in. Where the diffusion coefficient is high, then you don't have to have very much of a gradient to have a flux going in. So here the here's the alpha phase, so the diffusion coefficient is high, so very small gradient and got lots of flux. Here's the beta phase, so you know, relatively small gradient, you have lots of flux coming in. But between in the miscibility gap here, there's not very much diffusion coefficient. So if you want the same flux going in, you have to have a very big gradient. So what this means is that if you're loading your cathode, when you're loading it through the miscibility gap, you're probably going to have a discontinuity. Now, should we worry about that? Is there some reason I ought to be concerned about something like this? There might be. We remember yesterday we were talking about a 15% volume change between 0 and 1. So between here and here, there might be like a 7 or 8% volume change. 7 or 8% volume change, if it goes through as a front propagating through the material, it's going to do bad things. For example, if you have an alpha region, if you have nice big crystals that are well behaved, and you come through here with a pile driver of this discontinuity and loading, you break everything up and you get very tiny grains left over. That's what's observed with X-ray diffraction study. It's been observed since more than 50 years, X-ray diffraction studies of the lattice constant. This is one of the reasons why the electrochemists in Fleischmann's experiment tend to treat their cathodes very, very gently. You want to blow it really, really, really slowly and avoid doing this if at all possible.
Is that where the damage tends to happen? That change in that during that change is it's more susceptible to damage there than any other point? Or
I think that's true. I don't have any paper that says, let's study this in detail, let's look at this before it goes through, let's march it through, let's see it destroyed afterwards. So I don't have any papers that have studies like that, but I do have literature that says that this is a big issue.
You might be able to argue you can be less careful leading up to that, less careful after that, but during that change, which is very narrow, you can be
extra. So for example,
careful.
At SRI, they'll load at low current density very slowly for a long time. They'll just let the thing sit there and equilibrate. You take as many days as it wants. And then once they get into this region, then it's a little bit more robust. There are also grain effects. Oh,
are there experiments where it goes at a low rate, and then as it gets near this point, that they start to impulse advance the rate? Maybe is it, is there anything about it just all of a sudden does a stress relief and does a shift in the structure?
People do other things for stress relief. You know, the closest thing anybody's done to that, and if I had a phase diagram, I'd show you, but some people, in the phase diagram, if you can avoid the miscibility gap altogether, then you can avoid this effect. So if you go through a loading profile at high temperature initially, you can be above the miscibility gap completely if you're above the critical point. So there were some experiments reported in the 90s where people actually did that to try to help take care of their cathodes. There's grain effects as well, namely the diffusion we've talked about would apply going through a grain, but in the grain boundary, there's channels where the deuterium, the hydrogen, can go much faster, so both in and out. Okay, takeaway message. Diffusion's fast, slow in the miscibility gap because of Unzauger. we get a discontinuity in loading, and so forth and so forth. So that, a little bit about how the hydrogen gets in. And also, we're now sensitized to the notion that in the Fleischer-Prahn's experiment and at SRI, that the loading time is order of magnitude more and more longer than a diffusion time. So there's another time constant involved in the experiment that cannot be explained by diffusion. Okay, let me pause. Other questions or comments or thoughts? Okay. Resistance ratio. Now, we've been talking a lot about loading, and we said that loading is important. So if loading is important, do we have a way to measure the loading? We've actually talked about a number of ways. One is lattice parameter. If you have an X-ray neutron diagnostic, you can measure the lattice parameter. That's been done in loading experiments. Cathode volume, weight, orphan oxygen. Deuterium or hydrogen goes in and it came from water and the oxygen goes off, you can measure the oxygen to figure out how much deuterium or hydrogen is unaccounted for. And as Mitchell brought up the other day, electrical resistance, the resistance ratio is a popular method in this field. It's probably been the method used most. So the idea is that you get, as a function of loading, the resistance ratio goes up, comes down. This is sort of an old curve. I was trying to figure out, why does it do that? And you know, I was going through the literature looking for an obvious explanation. I didn't see an obvious explanation. And for very different reasons, I was working on another project. I had to go back to some old books, some of the old famous Mott and Massey metal, physics of metals from about 1940. And in that book, they said, well, It's obvious. It's an alloy effect. If you take a metal and you mix it with, and you alloy it with another metal, so you've got a binary alloy, and you measure the resistance as a function of the alloy going from one to the other, the curve goes up and comes back down. It's due to disorder. And if you like, putting hydrogen and palladium is funny kind of alloying. And initially you start with palladium, you're ending up with ordered palladium hydride, palladium deuteride, a loading of one, but in between the hydrogen and deuterium at a random site, so you have disorder. So you get an increase in resistance. So there it is. It's not peaking exactly at half, it's a little bit on the other side. There are reasons for that. But there you have it. But this is really cool because what it means is if you measure the resistance that you started with, you measure the resistance during your loading history, it'll go up, it comes back down. And you can tell from that what your loading was.
Would the dislocation that showed the previous slide also have be a factor in
that? The grain boundaries?
Grain boundaries.
Yeah, but hopefully there's not many grain boundaries in your cathode for reasons that we're going to get to. We haven't gotten to yet. Now, because this is such a big issue, a lot of people study the resistance ratio. Baranowski did some high-resolution measurements extending the curves to very high loading. So here's a loading of one, and the curves were extending in these high-pressure diamond anvil experiments to up to 1.1. So we now have these curves have a shape that's a little bit different. Hydrogen's a little bit different than deuterium. But we now have accurate calibration curves to get our loading from the resistance ratio measurement throughout the whole range of interest. So this has been done, and it's used regularly. It's an incredibly powerful tool. It was a tool that was not used very much in 1989, 1990, during all the experiments that got negative results. Thoughts, comments, or questions? Okay. Okay, basic electrochemical model. What can we say about electrochemistry and electrochemical modeling? Electrochemistry is, if you like, primarily an experimental field. You go and you do your measurements, you get data, you publish the data, you go on, you do your next measurements. Electrochemistry being very, very important. Now, I'm a theorist, and I'm not an electrochemist. When physicists talk about electrochemistry, they get into trouble real quick. So I'm going to go ahead and get myself into trouble by talking about electrochemical theory. From my point of view, electrochemistry is a mess. Namely, your surfaces, the ideal surfaces that you see in diagrams and so I'm going to be showing in real life, they've got all kinds of impurities on them. They've got coatings of this, that. The mechanisms, you know, you can do calculations for mechanisms based on idealized systems, but in the real world, you know, it's a gigantic mess. So from my perspective, the fact that you can do anything theoretical at all is stunning. And not only is it stunning, but it's important. And what I want to draw your attention to is that in the case of the reactions that put hydrogen and deuterium into palladium, the models that are associated with them are fantastic models. They're some of the success stories in theoretical electrochemistry. And they're called hydrogen evolution reaction or deuterium evolution reaction, HER reaction, DER reaction. They apply to many metals. And like I say, this is one of the major success stories in electrochemistry. I'm impressed. The hydrogen evolution reaction models, you can find it in electrochemical textbooks. And sort of featured as an example of how you can use theory in connection with electrochemistry. Now, the modeling is based on reactions. And so there are three potential reactions that are of interest. One is Vollmer reaction, which in base sort of works like this. So H2O or D2O comes to the surface, drops off an H or a D, picks up an electron, and goes off. So the basic idea is when H or D goes in, electron comes out, things go off, happy. There's Vollmer, he's happy, and we have a mechanism. There's the Vollmer reaction acids works a little bit differently, so draw your attention to it. It's not a unique. We're interested in the base here, the base version of Vollmer reaction, because Fleischmann-Pons were working with electrolyte, which was a base, lithium deuteroxide base. Tafel reaction hardly even looks like something associated with chemistry. It looks more like a physics kind of thing. If you have deuterium on the surface, you have another deuterium on the surface, well, if they find each other, make a molecule, they have the possibility of coming off. Tafel's happy with that. So Vollmer, Tafel, there's a third reaction which is under discussion. And if you think of the Vollmer reaction, I mean, you could talk about reactions and you know, they're science, so I can succeed in putting guys to sleep. On the other hand, if we try to make an analogy to something you can visualize, then you can understand it more intuitively. So think of Vollmer as Santa Claus. So Vollmer comes and brings the deuterium and gives it to the cathode. Cathode's happy. Fleischmann-Pons are happy. Everybody's happy. Kirovsky, he's the Grinch. So Kirovsky brings D2O to the surface. If there's a D happening to be on the surface, Christmas present, it gets grabbed and comes out, and it grabs the electron as well. So whereas Vollmer's loading, Kirovsky's deloading. And so I don't really like Kirovsky. Okay, so now, given the reaction mechanisms that are proposed, it's possible to put together a model. You might say, well, if you want to model it, you got to do this messy, complicated quantum mechanical reaction where you bring the D2 to the surface, you have to model it picking up the D, or dropping off a D, picking up an electron, moving away. Sounds very complicated. And I agree, it's very complicated. What's been found instead to be extremely effective is a model that's basically based on simpler thermodynamic kind of description. So here's the formula, And if you look at the formula, you know, I'm expecting your eyes are going to glaze over. On the other hand, if you remember some thermodynamics, the first thing you ought to look at is these exponential factors. And what you see up here, well, you see all kinds of terms, but what the terms came from was chemical potential of hydrogen or deuterium. And this one came from the chemical potential of the electron. So the basic idea for this one, the hydrogen and deuterium is going off. For this one, the hydrogen and deuterium are going in. I can tell it's going in because it's 1 minus theta. So this tells me if theta is 1, theta is the loading. If theta is the 1, then there's no open sites where hydrogen and deuterium can be blocked off. So what this says, this one says if I crank up the voltage, then the electron wants to go out more, which makes things be more successful overall. And this one here is for the chemical potential hydrogen. It's not so easy to see what's going on here. Maybe it's better to see it here. What it says here is if I have huge numbers of hydrogen and deuterium in the metal, then they want to leave, and I get an exponential factor that says they're going out at an exponentially increasing rate if I have a lot of loading. Anyway, that's kind of what the model does. There's some parameters in the model, and the question is, in order to use the model, can you figure out values for the parameters? So we can use the model, we can figure out values for the parameter. One parameter happens to do with the Frumpkin parameter. So the chemical potential looks something like this. This is the entropic, and this is the offset. And the offset, which is basically this and this, in the region above 0.6, is roughly linear. So it gets linearized. So in the model here, it's linearized. It's linearized. So what we see is that this Vollmer model is good above the miscibility gap. In fact, it's going to be good from here to here. If you want to use it at 1, you've got to kind of like do more. Electrochemists tend not to do more at the moment, but we could do more. So the question is what's the value of the slope here? And you can go to the literature, and Chun and Ra did some high-precision measurements of it, and they measured it at 0.514 electron volts for hydrogen. So that gives us the slope. And that slope is in the blue. And we can compare that slope from the blue with the slope we got last time that we got from the pressure and the loading curve, which is the black one. And these two curves, why are they the same? Yeah, they're good enough. So we get some idea of what we're doing, what the chemical potential is, and how it varies. In terms of the other parameters, there's a few other parameters. There was the magnitude of Vollmer current, and the beta was the coefficient for the electron chemical potential over potential part. Now, if you plot electrochemical current as a function of over potential from experiment, you get these curves going up. So these are called Tafel curves. And from the Tafel curves, you can use the model, compare it against the curves, figure out a value for beta and for the Vollmer coefficient. So from experiment directly, you can get the fitting parameters from the models, and you get a model that you can actually work with and use. So you can actually do some calculations that are based on thermodynamics and fitted to experiment. The analogous case for the Tafel reaction looks like this. The way to think about it is, if you look first in the exponentials, you just see the chemical potential. Well, there's an electron transfer, so that's what you'd expect. So, for example, this is the one that says, so I'm going to make molecules, I'm going to outgas, I'm going to lose hydrogen gas. So you see a factor of 2, you're going to have 2 because it takes 2 hydrogens to make a molecule, 2 deuteriums to make a molecule. So this is the term that says if the loading gets larger, that the gas comes spewing out exponentially faster. This one feels like the loading, surface loading squared. Well, you can have 2 of them to come together, which is why it's squared. And there's a fitting parameter. So you've got to go to the data and figure out what the fitting parameter is. Now, at low current density, Hairovsky's not believed to play a role, so Vollmer and Taffler are busy fighting it out. So Vollmer brings deuterium into the metal, Taffler brings it out. So in equilibrium, the amount going in is the same as the amount going out. So here's the amount going in by Vollmer. There were two terms, but the one going in is more important under conditions of loading. And here's Taffler. Well, there were two terms. The one going out is more important when the loading is significant. So if you set this one equal to this one, you get this relationship where the loading is here, all the constants in the electrical potential, the overpotential is over there. So this gives you an adsorption isotherm, so you can figure out what the loading is, function over potential, temperature, and all the other parameters by solving this equation. This equation is not a difficult equation to solve, which means we can apply theory to experiment. We can actually begin to understand how things work. So for example, here is experimental data from Green and Fritz, 1996. Similar data was available in 1989, but you see curve going up, over potential, you get loading. Here's blue curve from our isotherm formula. Here's loading experimental data. So in this region here, other things are happening other than Vollmer and Taffler, but in this region, Vollmer and Taffler dominate everything. Vollmer, deuterium going in, hydrogen going in, Taffler, hydrogen going out, and we have agreement between theory and experiment. In fact, we can get the fitting parameters down to the percent level, and we can really do theory. And pause for a moment. Are you guys impressed? Okay, so let's think more about this. So under conditions, Fleisch-Pond experiment, there's Fleisch-Pond's first report was at 10th molar lithium deuteroxide. It was a salt in the electrolyte. Other people ran at 1 molar lithium deuteroxide. A little bit of salt's good, more is better, maybe. And you get different curves. So this is also from Green and Fritz. And I thought, wow, I can see the effect of the salt on here. After trying to model it, and I couldn't get my models to work very well, I emailed Fritz and I said, is this real? He goes, no, it's not real. These two curves are the same. One cathode is a little bit different than the other cathode. But what we see is that you increase the current by cranking up the voltage, which increases the overpotential. So when the current goes from milliamp per square centimeter, 10 milliamp per square centimeter, 100 milliamp per square centimeter, which happens to be, this end happens to be the region of interest for Fleisch-Pond's experiment, you can see that the more current you turn on by increasing the overpotential, the more loading you get. And in this region, the curves are described by these Vollmer-Taffler models. So we're starting to understand things. I mean,
what is the definition of the overpotential?
The overpotential in this particular case has to do with the chemical potential of the electron at the cathode surface involved in getting it to the reacting species. There's additional contribution of the cell potential from the electrolyte and the anode and so forth. So digging down, getting the overpotential associated with the cathode surface takes a little bit of work to do by itself. So that helpful. Okay, now the thing I'm looking at here is that Green and Fritz are good electrochemists. This is published data. I'm looking at the region, and this region we argued was interesting for cold fusion. And I'm seeing loading going up to 0.8, 0.82. And I'm scratching my head and I'm thinking, well, 0.8, 0.82, that's sort of the loading that was achieved at Caltech for their negative experiment. So let me go back and review this. And that back in 1989, 1990, there was a lot of discussion about loading being important. of all these hundreds of negative results, if you go through and you look at each paper, you go one paper, what was your loading? Not measured. Next paper, what was your loading? Not measured. Next paper, what was your loading? Not measured. Now, to their credit, there were two of the premier groups measured their loading. MIT, MIT's MIT, of course they're going to measure their loading. So the loading is 0.75. And I'm scratching my head, 0.75, that doesn't seem so high to me for some reason. At Caltech, there were three measurements, 0.77, 0.79, 0.80. You know, we understand that it's exponentially more difficult to load higher. Caltech loaded 5 points higher. Caltech experiment far better than MIT experiment in terms of loading, 5 points. And more importantly, consistent with Green and Britt's loading, consistent with the literature. So you go and you hassle Nate Lewis in 1989, say your loading's not high enough. Nate Lewis looks at the literature. Our loading's consistent with the literature. This is what you'd expect to get for any loading under these conditions. So takeaway message. We got a reaction model, hydrogen evolution reaction, which is a success story in electrochemistry. Gives a basic picture for how loading works. More importantly, it gives us equations that we can solve and analyze and even understand how things work. Hydrogen brought to the electrode by Volmer, leads by Tafel. And we can actually use these models rationally reasonably if we've got Tafel curves to reference our overpotential on, if we've got loading curves to reference the other parameters on. Okay, takeaway message. Questions, thoughts, comments?
So is temperature a factor in this?
Definitely.
It didn't seem to be in those equations.
Everything was divided by KT. All the exponentials had KT underneath. It was definitely in the equations. So basically, the temperature is lower. The electrochemists view that it's easier to load. It's much harder to load when the temperature gets higher. Other comments or questions or thoughts? Well, strictly speaking, the situation's now pretty good. From a
did you just say the temperature is easier to load when the temperature's lower?
What I said is that among the electrochemists, they generally have the feeling that it's easier to get high loading at lower temperature.
Oh, that's a surprise. Okay.
So now let's look at excess power versus loading. Mitchell talked about this yesterday. I talked about this some yesterday. So Fleischmann ponds basically jumped up and down about the loading. Now, of course, Fleischmann's a little bit obscure. Fleischmann actually didn't talk about loading. He talked about the difference in the potential between the cathode and reference electrode and gave us numbers in terms of offset voltages. So you had to reach a number 0.7 electron, or 0.7 volts. You scratch your head and you say, what the heck does that mean? Well, essentially what that means is you have to have the loading be high. So Caltech was criticized for insufficiently loading. Caltech said that their loading was plenty high and the problems with the experiment just didn't work. So what we're interested in now is going back. Now there's been a lot of experiments, a lot of data. We can go back in retrospect and see what the answer is and see how things work. So for example, this was one of the early experiments which showed an effect. Now, staring at this, on this curve, on this axis here is the loading. So here's 0.77, 0.8, 0.86, 0.92. And this curve right here is the loading as measured by the resistance ratio using the earlier resistance ratio curve, which is not quite as accurate as the later one. So here's a loading of 0.83, here's a loading of 0.92, and excess heat seems to come when the loading is high. When the loading is low, there doesn't seem to be much excess heat. So the electrochemist looked at that and he said, well, why don't we plot our data? Excess heat is a function of loading. So here's loading, here's excess heat, power watts, 0, 1.2. Curve goes up and it's sort of parabolic exponential, some curve that increases. Here's 0.85, here's 0.87, 0.89. So the basic notion is you want to get high loading in order to get excess heat. At the same conference that McCoubrey presented his SRI results, Ken Motz presented analogous results, completely independent of each other. They happen to be studying the same thing. They got sort of equivalent results. So here's Kinematsu, excess heat percent, 20%, 40%. So how many percent do you have before you think that there's something there? Loading, maybe 0.84, 0.85, and off you go. And as you get to higher loading, this curve's going up. I don't know if it's parabolic or exponential, but it's clearly increasing. Takeaway message. Fleischmann especially emphasized that you need high loading to see the effect. Excess heat in those experiments and in many other experiments is observed to be correlated with high loading. Takeaway message, time for me to catch my breath and entertain questions. Do we have entertaining questions?
What were the highest loadings achieved in that 89? A few years of experiments, did they get the one? Was it the most? What was the most that anyone attempted and succeeded at that measurement?
Good question. I know that loadings in the neighborhood of 0.95 or thereabouts were achieved in the early 90s. I don't know the numbers for 89 and 90. It took a while for the. Only a few laboratories used the resistance ratio curves early. And then there's issues about the calibration of high loading and so forth. So,
how did MIT and Caltech calculate their loadings? Did they do the same method, or how did they scale?
They used weight. They measured the weight of the kappa, which actually is a different measurement than the resistance ratio. The resistance ratio is usually understood as getting at the bulk loading. And if you've got grain boundaries and crevices, you've got hydrogen that can hang out there that won't show up as part of the bulk loading, but will show up in the weight. So the weight numbers, if anything, a little bit high.
Now, the quality of the cathode, did that play into this at all?
The amount of discussion about the cathodes was, it dominated the discussion of the experiments in 1989, 1990. The only other issue was the calorimetry, which received as much discussion. We're going to talk a little bit about the cathodes, and I'm going to make an argument as to one factor that's important in the cathodes shortly. So I want to revisit this electrochemical model. Now, there's a headache here. Green and Britz published data like this, and we've got the models. So we've got Vollmer and Tafel in this region. Perhaps we could add Hyrovsky, which makes the lines curve over, and we could fit all the parameters to these curves. And in fact, that was done. Now, the only thing is these curves seem to run out of steam. If you like, they peter out at a loading somewhere near 0.8, 0.82 or so. And if it's required that you have to get up to 0.9 or 0.95 loading, and your curves, namely the good experimental curves plus the Vollmer-Tafel models, consistent with this lower loading, then maybe it's like having to have a unicorn for the loading in order to get excess heat. So, for example, Zhang et al., applied physicists doing modeling of the experimental data, took data of Akita et al., were called fusioneers who measured the loading as a function of current density. So here's the Vollmer-Tafel region, fits beautifully with the Vollmer-Tafel models. And what Zhang did is he used the Hyrovsky model and managed to fit the data at the high end as well. So we've got theory, we've got experiment, we've got happiness all through. We have a peak loading here of 0.84, 0.85, something like that. And we're not getting the 0.95s. Anyone bothered by this at all yet? Let's consider this. This was some reasonably early data. This was taken at SRI. And I want to look at this curve for a moment. So I see three traces on it. I'm scratching my head trying to figure out what the traces are. Okay, I see resistance ratio on this side, and this curve right here has to do with the resistance ratio. So we said it was humped, and you got to go down. So at early time, it went up, and here's two. So it went up, it's coming down. So when it's coming down, we're getting high loading. So it goes down to about 1.63. So if I go to, well, I went to 1.6 here. And if I read down on the calibration curve, I get a loading of 0.93. And this curve right here is the current density in amps per square centimeter. So this is going, this point right here is like, I don't know, 250 milliamps per square centimeter, which is a respectable high current density. I think this is the cell voltage probably. So what we're seeing is we have an example in 1996 of a loading of 0.93. And that doesn't seem to be consistent with the Green and Britt's electrochemical data. And if you fit the Vollmer-Tafel models and Nyarovsky models, the Green and Britt's data and the Akita data, you don't get anywhere near 0.93. Here's another example with superwaves. So the resistance ratios on this curve, here's 1.9, 1.7, 1.5, 1.3. These black curves are resistance ratio data. So I've gone over the hump at 2, they're coming down, and they come down, they come down, come down. Now you recall that the superwave profile is the shaking the desk drawer business where you have big amplitude at high frequency. And so here we're going down to a resistance ratio of, I don't know, 1.35, 1.37 or something like that. That's a really low resistance ratio. And this is the associated loading, and the loading's on this side. And corresponding to this resistance ratio is this loading, and this loading is up here around 0.98, 0.99. So we have experimental observations of very high loading. And at some point, we're beginning to be uncomfortable. We thought we understood from the textbook models from electrochemistry that Vollmer, Tafel, that, you know, we knew how the loading worked. But here's experiments giving us much higher loading. So the question is, how do we understand? So Vollmer loads 1 deuterium per electron. Tafel deloads. At low current density, that's all that's going on. Essentially, all other processes at higher current density basically reduce the efficiency of the Vollmer-Tafel business. So the basic question is, why in the world is the loading ever higher than 0.84? How can we understand that? And we should be able to understand it from Vollmer and Tafel. So we go back to Vollmer and Tafel and to steady state. So under steady state conditions, Vollmer current equals Tafel current. So we said, this was Vollmer, that's Tafel, and we get our isotherm. But our isotherms were predicting low loading, experiments predicting very high loading. So who's broken? Vollmer or Tafel? So, now, after staring at this for a long time, I thought, well, Vollmer seems to be okay to me. Namely, you do measurements, you get the deuterium to go in, the hydrogen goes out. So I'm actually happier with Vollmer. There's a lot of experimental evidence that seems to stack up that I should have faith in Vollmer. Tafel, on the other hand, Tafel looks to me to be suspect. You might say, how can Tafel look suspect? So imagine you got a surface, you got your deuterons that come together, off goes a deuteron, or deuterium molecule. What's wrong with that? And I'm thinking, well, nothing's wrong with that at all. The only problem is what do you consider to be a surface? So is the surface the outside of the cathode, or does the surface inside include things internal? I mean, suppose you have grain boundaries, voids, occlusion, this, that, everything else. Suppose you say, well, the mistake that we're making here is that when we fit to the Green and Brits data, we're not calculating the area right, that we didn't include all the internal surface area. So if we say that, then basically we're saying that your average generic cathode leaks like a sieve, and that in order to get the high loading, you need a cathode that doesn't have internal leaks and doesn't leak like a sieve. So the question is, how big of an effect is this? I mean, are we talking about having twice as much internal surface area as external surface area? Well no. What we're talking about is if we take this interpretation and we say, let's take the best cathode that's ever been observed and say, what loading did it reach at what current density? And basically, at current densities of 10 milliamps per square centimeter, cathodes have been observed to load to something in the general neighborhood of 0.98, which is phenomenal, heroic, it's amazing, it's stunning. Let's suggest that under those conditions, there are no internal leaks. If we've got a hero cathode, it's as good as it can be. We get a curve there. So to get Green and Brits cathode, or your average MIT or Caltech cathode, or the average cathode everybody's using in 1989, how much internal leaks do you have? Well, here's a factor of 10 more than the surface tafel. Here's internal leaks 100 times the rate of the external surface, 1,000. You've got to go up to about 5,000 times more internal leaks than surface leaks tafel to make sense of the data. But once you do make sense of the data this way, now you can have models systematically based on Homer and tafel that take into account the experimental data throughout. And from this, you say that, what's the problem? The problem is stupid cathodes leak like a sieve.
Mm-hmm. How would you measure the number?
This ratio? What's measured is the loading is measured using the resistance ratio, where the cell current, the electrochemical current, is measured in equilibrium. The Vollmer current matches the tafel current, which means I can isolate the tafel current as a function.
So 500 is a number which is computed.
5,000 is a number which is about the only number that's going to be remotely consistent with the experimental data using this picture. And it is computed. So this is a huge effect. And it tells us something. It tells us that if we want to get high loading, there's lots of things we can worry about. But the first thing we should worry about is internal leaks. So there's a friend of mine, Vittorio Violante. I think we're still friends. Yes, hopefully we're still. But Violante was interested in metallurgy. And Violante is closer to a comment that was made earlier. Violante wanted to reduce the internal stresses, because in Violante's view, the internal stresses were the big deal. But Violante did reported, at least earlier and subsequently similar, maybe took a foil, say 70 microns thick, and annealed it. Well, when you anneal it, you heat it up and recrystallize, and you get big grains. So here are the big grains. Here's 100 microns. Here's a big grain. It's 50, 70 microns in size. So the grain size in these cathodes, which achieve very high loading, is on the same order as the foil thickness in this particular case. So for example, if you have a grain size, you got uniformity over region is sort of on the order of the foil thickness. If you're one grain going through, you're not got any internal leaks associated with that grain. You've got grain boundaries, but if you minimize the grain boundaries to the grains, then it seems like you're gonna maximize your loading. So Violante and others studied loading, peak loading as a function. Here's temperature during the annealing process. Basically, if you anneal too high temperature and grains are too big, then fragile and breaks and doesn't load quite as well. You don't do enough annealing, the grains are too small, you've got lots of internal leaks, you've got cathodes that leak like a sieve. So by studying this, Violante was able to produce cathodes which loaded to very high loading routinely and regularly. If Vittoria goes out of business, then this part of the field goes out of business. Takeaway message. Takeaway message, basically, internal leaks, in my perspective, is the biggest effect that made the cathodes not load particularly well in 1989, 1990. Huge effect, 3,000, 5,000 times more leaking internally than from the outer surface. You fix that, the cathodes load better, and they load to a region that's relevant. Takeaway message slide, time for me to catch my breath and entertain questions. What do you think? Questions, comments?
So the leaks are happening at the grain size as opposed to the molecular level. I mean, grains are multiple molecules, right? They're large.
Grains can be large, grains can be small, it depends on how you process your metal. The argument here is that if you don't pay attention to how your metal is processed, your average cathode is going to have lots of internal leaks. It's not going to load very well. And in 1989, consistent with the literature, loading curves were established on leaky cathodes. The notion that you could get rid of the internal leaks wasn't part of the literature back in 1989.
The shape of the grains but the grains are at the grain level is where those leaks would occur. That's how you kind of solve or improve that situation.
A good question. I happen not to be a metallurgist, so I'm pointing at internal leaks. You might expect internal leaks from grain boundaries, voids, inclusions, other defects inside the metal. But past that, I have to refer to literature and metallurgists.
Has anyone tried to grow palladium kind of epi growth to get rid of or to get the cool
cathode? If you've got the availability of annealing, there's no point to it. If you have an existing piece of metal and you just have to put it in an oven, warm it up, cool it down for appropriate protocol, you're done. You got a good piece of metal. You know, building one up atom by atom is a fair amount of work. We'll actually talk about that shortly.
I was just curious if there had been any experiments with very small single crystal, or if that's just too...
Well, again, years earlier, experiments were done with single crystals. So electrochemical loading of single crystals was tried, and people from X-ray studies found that it broke up into many grains very quickly. So the idea is to start out with grains on the order of the size of your foil, grains that are bigger, minimize the internal leaks, and then once you got a cathode, a good cathode, load it slowly, load it gently, be aware that if you load too fast, you're going to completely destroy the innards of it. It's going to leak like a sieve.
I think it's actually worse. I think you've left off contamination as another cause. The deposition by the applied electric field intensities of low hydrogen over voltage sites. I'll be showing pictures where when we see the bubbling, we see them where these materials are deposited, and there's a lot of energy that's wasted at that point.
I am going to talk about deposition shortly.
But these are bad depositions. Okay. And these quench the reaction.
Yeah, there are good depositions, there are bad depositions. Okay, let's revisit this palladium deuteride high loading business as a requirement for excess heat. So Fleisch and Pons emphasized this in 1989-1990. In many experiments, excess heat is correlated with loading. There's an additional correlation that is going to come into the picture.
What is PXI?
Excess
power.
What was the
loading that Fleischmann and Pons achieved? Fleischmann and Pons didn't report their loading. Fleischmann and Pons reported potential differences between the cathode and the reference electrode. Only Caltech did experiments of that variety back in 1989. Nobody subsequently has done measurements like that. Hartwell did similar measurements.
So they didn't basically know how high their loading was?
if you go back and you read what Fleischman wrote, Fleischman was of the opinion that he reached a loading of 1.5 or so in the bulk, which is impossible. On the other hand, the Harwell negative result measuring the loading the same way that Fleischman posited got lower differences between the cathode and reference voltage. So their loading was definitely lower. Nobody's gone back to sort it out. I'm of the opinion that Fleischmann-Pons got very high loading, you know, well into the high 0.9s. Okay, so this is a curve that's a different kind of curve than the one we saw before. The one we saw before said that if your loading was above 0.85, you got excess heat. But at SRI, cathodes were seen where the loading got to 0.85 and no excess heat was observed. So the question was, is there a correlation, is there a different kind of correlation between loading and excess heat? So the question on the table is, suppose we say that loading's important. Is there a loading that the cathode had to have reached sometime during its loading history? So the idea is that the cathodes started out in a farm, big farm, lots of cathodes loading. Some loaded badly, some loaded very well. They take the ones that load very well, they move to the calorimeter and they continue doing experiments. So they have a loading history over months, 6 weeks, 2 months. And the question is can we sort between the ones that worked and the ones that didn't work based on the peak loading that the cathodes reached sometime during their loading history? And this is an early result of that. So, for example, experiment P1, P17, P22, P19, all of these worked. L1, L2, L7, L10, they didn't work. And this down here is now peak loading obtained during the loading history. This isn't loading at the time of excess heat. This was what's the highest loading that was achieved during the history of the cathode. And basically what we find is that at a loading of about 0.95 and higher, pretty much everything works. And a loading 0.95 and lower, pretty much everything doesn't work. So this is a second, separate, distinct loading requirement on the cathodes. Instead of saying that you just have to reach 0.84 to get excess heat, what this says is your cathode better have seen a loading of about 0.95. Or else forget it.
Are all these cathodes the same shape?
This particular one, I believe, is 2006 would have been calculated with the new data. Here's a summary of that more recent one. And what you see here, so red is positive excess heat at SRI, and this is the number of experiments that showed positive excess heat. So this one, 17, and here's, I'm going to guess that's 0.95. And to be honest, I'm not sure I can tell from, oh, I see, you read it going this way. So this is 0.94. Now the green is positive excess heat at Ennio Frascati in Italy. This is Vittoria's group. So we can see that these are the ones that worked. We can compare that with basically all of the relevant measurements available from 1989-1990, the ones that didn't work. Of course, there's not very many of them. And at MIT, we've got a 0.74 and 0.78. At Caltech, we got a 0.78 and a 0.8. So here's what doesn't work, here's what does work. And at SRI, no cathode that had a peak loading of 0.8 during its loading history was observed to do anything. So the conclusion that we come to is that loading is a key parameter for the production of excess heat back in 1989-1990, in spite of the admonitions of Fleischmann-Pons, of Huggins, of McCubry, of others. Loading was uncontrolled in the large number of negative experiments. And as we see now, you only, in the SRI data set, you only get positive results when the peak loading reaches a very high value. This was not done at Caltech, this is not done at MIT, And there's no evidence that any of the 100 or more negative experiments in 1989 or 1990 reached a loading high enough that you would have expected anything to happen at all. This is one of the reasons why I don't think there's any chance that there could possibly have been any excess heat in the MIT results.
In this aspect, the Fishman and Ponza were able, in a certain way, to create a cathode where the structure was so, let's say, with the big rings, so that their maximum loading was higher.
How about Fleischmann and Pons worked with Matthew Johnson and sorted through a ridiculously large number of cathodes and evolved towards a cathode source of Johnson-Matthew and a protocol that got very high voltage differences between reference cathode or active cathode and reference electrode as a way to approach high loading. It's not something that happened by accident. It's not something that happened just by random experimentation. It happened by purposeful experimentation where Fleischmann was trying to get the loading as high as he could get. Mm-hmm. And the argument for it is that the areas where the loading was low had been explored for many years. Regions of high loading had not been very highly explored in electrochemistry, which attracted Fleischmann's interest in it. And the same argument worked for McCoubre.
As I understand it, McCoubre got his cathodes from the same source, right?
No. No. McCoubre got his cathodes from Engelhardt. So many of these runs were done with Engelhardt batch 1. Engelhardt batch 2 didn't work at all. Engelhardt batch 3 didn't work at all. But Vittorio's cathodes work.
Okay. So just so I understand, the cathode only has to achieve that level of loading at some point, but not necessarily during the run. Is that what you're saying? Is that
what the sorting was to say? Let's look at the entire loading history. What's the highest loading that was obtained during the loading history? And excess heat, when it actually occurs, can happen at lower loading than the 0.95.
I see.
So I'm imagining what might be happening here. I think about D's or H's pushing their way and making the lattice bigger, 15%. And I imagine that when they leave, when they unload, they might leave the lattice the same size or something. I don't know what happens, but they must leave some effect when they unload, if there's an effect of having them unloaded. Can you talk about what those effects might be? Or?
I am going to talk about.
Oh, okay. great. Okay. Also, would that affect the way that you measure loading with resistivity, resistance?
There certainly is some change in the shape and morphology of the cathode, so that this nice loading ratio of 2 in experiments, you don't hit 2 on the nose. It might be bigger. It might be smaller. So there are issues like that. With respect to the deuterium molecule leaving the cathode, if the chemical potential is very high, then when it leaves, it has more energy. It pushes harder, kicks harder. But I don't actually think that that's what's significant here.
In this particular paper that was in, McCoubre talked about why the performance tended to become reduced at the higher loadings once it reached, it went beyond 0.96.
Why did the performance be reduced?
Did he talk about, it seems like the excess heat that was observed kind of peaked and then fell off after a certain amount.
Actually, how about a different interpretation? How about that getting 0.94 is easier than getting 0.96 loading as a peak loading, and getting 0.96 is easier than getting 0.98. Fewer cathodes reach the really heroic loading part. This would be more a statement of small number of heroic, but a large number of less heroic, but still sufficiently heroic to do some good.
The axis on the left is number of successes, not excess heat.
Yeah, number of successes.
I'm sorry, I missed it.
Okay. Yeah, in my view, none of these large number of excess heat measurements, MIT, Caltech, Harwell, Bell Labs, and so forth, except for Harwell. Harwell had a chance of seeing some excess heat. The rest of them, basically no chance whatsoever. And to weight them so heavily, as has been done by John Huizenga, by the ERAD panel, by Steve Coonan, by Department of Energy, by Scientific American, and so forth, is just completely out to lunch. I do not know why anyone would weight that body of work as heavily as it's weighted. Takeaway message, the loading ratio is known now to be important for excess heat. We have two different criteria. We've got a peak loading criterion of 0.95. We've got a lower criterion of 0.84 or 0.85 during the time of excess heat. So they're two different constraints, and there's going to be two different arguments or interpretations. And as I said, the published naked results are from experiments that should probably not have been expected to work, and to weight them as proving that Fleischmann-Pott experiments doesn't work and can't be reproduced is nuts. Okay, takeaway message then. Comments or thoughts?
You talked about some batches working and some not. Will you be going into that?
No. Basically, perhaps one of the biggest examples is in connection with the Japanese METI project. So Japan put in $30 to $50 million for a replication effort based on the early positive results. And they defined a cathode to be a 4/9 pure palladium cathode. And they defined the experiment otherwise as being consistent with either Fleischmann-Pott's protocol or SRI protocol. So at SRI, hundred experiments or more were done with these very pure cathodes. And in none of those experiments was any excess heat observed. And the critics looked at that and they said, see, now when you finally have a well-controlled experiment in your own calorimeters, you're seeing nothing. In fact, SRI was almost at the point of giving up and throwing in the towel because it'd been just an unbroken string of zeros. So I said, well, any idea why these cathodes aren't working? And so I said, well, how do they fail? Well, they split open like an overripe banana. They crack. So later on, we scratched our head and we were, going over the entrails of the experiment. And it turns out that 5/9 pure palladium has a yield strength of something in the general neighborhood of half a gigapascal. And what was observed when you're looking at an experiment is that at a certain loading, you can figure out, based on the arguments we gave, what the equivalent pressure is. So at the loading that you need to make the experiment work, the internal pressure exceeds the yield strength of the 5/9 pure palladium. Which basically means every one of those cathodes should have cracked open at the points where they did crack open. And there's no way that you could have gotten any excess heat whatsoever. So in that particular case, a very expensive and a very painful exercise in learning that if you have impurities in your metal, in the case of palladium, at a level of 10⁻³ or thereabouts, you can actually raise the yield strength if the impurities are right. Case and have stronger palladium that works much better. So that's an example.
If the cathode cracks, why should it fail?
The cathode cracks, you've got a huge amount of surface available, new fresh surface available for TAFL to go. And TAFL goes exceedingly fast. At very high loading, the chemical potential is very high. Ansacker kicks in, all the hydrogen goes to where it can leak out. Okay, we're gonna now turn to some more known physics, but we're interested in why the loading's high, And we're actually going to be introducing a thought, a conjecture, an ansatz. And the ansatz is that if we follow Fleischmann's conjecture that maybe DD fusion is happening in some new way that nobody's ever thought about, what we can do, instead of worrying about how that happens or all the ramifications of that, is we can be much more crude and say, suppose he's right. What's it take to get two Ds together? So what I want to do is I want to turn to that problem, and I want to apply known physics now, known physical chemistry to material science to that problem. So now that motivates us to be interested in the problem of D2 formation in palladium deuterite. And we can use standard techniques to understand it. And the place I want to start is a simpler system. Simpler systems are always easier to understand, so I want to start with a simpler system. Suppose I put hydrogen next to palladium. Well, hydrogen will stick next to palladium. You can make a molecule, diatomic molecule, palladium hydride. And the separation between the palladium and the hydrogen is, from calculations, 1.53 angstrom. So quantum chemistry calculations have been done on these different states. Subramanian and co-workers. Actually, this work is pretty cool work. They were the very first ones to apply a relativistic analysis to moderately high C diatomic molecule. So what we find is we get binding curves like you normally see in molecules. The lowest one here is for the ground state. You get a separation, which 1.53 angstroms. You get a binding energy, which is 0.08 Hartrees. Hartrees, in this case, I think is 13.6, so some 0.8 to insert a little bit more than a volt. That was one of two. It's one of volt binding energy. Now, I'd like to understand that in some boneheaded kind of way. And it turns out there's a theory that back in the 1980s was unbelievably successful. And it'll take a little bit of explaining here. The basic idea is that before that time, the notion of how a solid worked was basically masses and springs. So you've got palladium in a lattice, and the interaction between the palladium, well, there's some interaction potential between them. And if you parameterize that interaction, you can get your model for the palladium solid. And you can get agreement between basics of the solid and your model. You can make a connection between the two. Now, sadly, if you have radial potentials, all your solids tend to end up being HCP kind of structures, and palladium is a BCC structure, so in order to do it right, you actually have to add some angular dependence. So there's some wrinkles, but it can be done, and it's very effective, and there are a very large number of papers out there that describe the structure of metals using simple potentials between the metal atoms. Now, experiments were done with helium, I think helium scattering measurements, and they were being interpreted based on these potential models. And the fits weren't quite as good as you would like. And there was a school of thought, people working with density functional models, who thought that you ought to be able to apply density functional ideas to understand the interaction between helium and the metals. And basically, if I fast forward through a lot of the arguments, it sort of works like this. So this is a delta up here. So if you put helium near in a chemical environment or a solid state environment where there's background electrons, and depending on how much background electron density you have, your helium exhibits an increase in energy. Scratch your head and say, well, why should that happen? So imagine that there's this theoretical stuff called jullium, which says instead of having atoms, you've got this uniformly charged background of ions. And then you put electrons in, electrons go there and you can do calculations with them at convenient. So now if you have your jelly and you put in a helium atom, what you find is the interaction raises the energy. The more electrons you have, the harder it is to stick your helium in it. And at relatively low electrons per cubic angstrom, you start accumulating several volts of energy. Now, if you like, that has a very interesting interpretation. In fact, maybe the right thing to do is to go to that interpretation and come back. So let me think about helium in palladium. So you can calculate the background density, electron density, due to the palladium atoms. So you can imagine your helium going in, and plot. Let me go back. I apologize for jumping back and forth, but the point's pretty interesting. So here's the background electron density in the case of palladium. So at the O site, you have a relatively low electron density. At the T site, you have a little bit higher electron density. And so if you try to put helium into palladium, well, if it's bulk palladium, you would expect it to show up here because the electron density is lower. And to go from here to here, well, you could calculate the difference in the electron density, go back to the curve and figure out how much difference you get in embedding energy. And I think the number is like 1.3 volts, 1.5 volts or something like that. So let me go. So at the O site, you have to have 3.2 volts of embedding energy to go there. You expect O site occupation in agreement with experiment, not T site occupation. You expect low solubility because 3 volts is a lot of volts, so helium's not soluble in palladium near room temperature. You'll expect it to leak out or seek internal voids. Moreover, I'm actually thinking that one way to study the background electron density in palladium is to look at helium diffusion. So for example, if you look at the delta E for the O to T transition from that simple superposition model, then you'd assume that you get a volt and a half to go from one to the next, and you have to go from one to the next to diffuse. Now, if you look at the diffusion of palladium and helium, you get numbers between 0.7 and 1 electron volts. And you might say, well, that's not 1.5, but helium's sort of big in the lattice, and when it moves from the O site to the T site, it moves some of the other atoms around. So I'm actually of the opinion, well, the literature values are actually done this way, including relaxation. So it would seem to me that you could actually use helium diffusion as a way to test for the background electron density in the metals. This hasn't been done systematically, but it could be done, and it probably should be done as a way. Anyway, this is to give you an idea that the embedding energy, the embedded atom picture, is a tool. It agrees with, generally it agrees with density functional, more sophisticated calculations that people do these days. But the thing is that this gives us some intuition as to how things work. And intuition is really useful when you can make use of it. So let me now go back to the molecule. So what I want to do now is I want to think about hydrogen near palladium in terms of this embedded atom theory. So first noticed in the experiments of helium as described, and the helium embedded atom problem is really simple. The more electron density, the higher the energy, so that's that. Now, embedded atom, this picture of having a hydrogen or helium embedded in background electron density, the reason it's useful has to do with polarizability. So for example, helium has low polarizability, hydrogen has a bigger polarizability, but relatively low absolute polarizability. Because of its low polarizability, then if you like, if the exchange energy is dominating this low polarizability, And if you forget about the polarizability completely, you can understand the dynamics just from the exchange energy, which is sort of what the embedded atom picture's doing. So let me now go. People then have modeled the embedding energy of hydrogen in Joulian. I'm cheating here. I'm taking an early embedding picture. So the way to look at this is that here's electron density. At high electron density, the embedding energy just simply goes up, like it did for helium. But hydrogen is different than helium because at low density, it goes up too. And there's a particular density which hydrogen wants to see. And that's interesting. Now, the authors of this paper is Norskott, Bessenbacher, Myers. These guys are, they were the early proponents of embedded atom theory. And their papers have like thousands of citations and so forth. This is really a big deal. These ideas are really big deal, really important. And Norskott and Bessenbacher were also some of the biggest critics of cold fusion back in 1989. So I have to apologize to them for making use of their very good ideas and trying to understand Fleischmann-Pons experiment. But let me take this curve. So I guess if there's going to be a minimum in the embedding energy, probably the electron density where this occurs is important. So for reference, this is occurring at about 0.069 electrons per cubic angstrom. So question is, what's the background electron density for hydrogen near palladium in the molecule? So what I did is I wrote a relativistic Hartree-Fock code years ago, and I can calculate electron densities near palladium, so I calculated it. So here's what the electron density looks like near palladium. And if I go out to 1.53 angstroms where the hydrogen sits, the electron density is 0.069 electrons per cubic angstrom. So I look at this number, and I look at the number from embedding energy, and this is the same number. And I scratch my head and I think about this, and I'm going to slightly misuse their ideas. And I'm going to say, well, the boneheaded way to think about it is that the hydrogen actually wants to see a particular electron density. And when it gets near palladium in the molecule, it's looking for that electron density, and it finds it. And that's sort of how the molecule works in this boneheaded point of view. Now, I'm oversimplifying things dramatically. But a boneheaded point of view is really useful and helpful. So it's not perfect, but it's capturing a fair amount of the problem. So there we have it. Now, mind you, I have cheated some because I've used an early embedding function, which gives me a particularly good match in this case. So what about hydrogen in palladium hydride? Can I do the same thing here? And the answer is I can. So here's the lattice. This is a sodium chloride structure, as we recall. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start at this palladium atom. I'm going to go through the middle, and I'm going to end up at the palladium atom on the far side. So this is called the 111 direction. So if I look in the 111 direction, and I do a simple superposition of electron densities, I get a curve that looks like this, which I showed before. But now I'm looking at it with new eyes. So I'm thinking, embedding electron density, minimum energy for my embedding function for electron density is 0.069 electrons per cubic angstrom. Well, the lowest electron density here is 0.08. one electrons per cubic angstrom. It's a little bit higher than what the hydrogen atom wants to see. Now, the T sites, which are other places where the hydrogen can sit, maybe, has a higher electron density, and at the higher electron density, well, the embedding energy is much higher. It's actually fairly far away from the optimum. So we conclude from this that palladium autoloads its hydrogen in the octahedral sites, And the boneheaded reason for it is because that's where the electron density is closest the electron density wants to see. What do you think? That's actually a pretty powerful statement that we're getting sort of almost for free from this intuition, which in my view is one of the gigantic advantages of having this very powerful boneheaded point of view. Mm-hmm. So what's interesting, I guess in this calculation, the electron density is 0.079 at the O site, a little bit higher than 0.069, which is the optimum. T sites is much higher, and we conclude we've got some basic understanding of why the hydrogen's going where it's going, you know, palladium. We're going to be talking about nickel on Friday, but since we're talking about this, no reason not to think about nickel. What's nickel look like? Well, here's a similar calculation background electron density for nickel with a lattice constant that of, I don't actually remember if this is normal nickel or stretched nickel. I think this might be normal nickel. So the electron density here looks closer to 0.13. And scratching and thinking about that 0.13 electron, or the hydrogen is not going to be very happy there. Electron density is too high. So I would conclude from this, I would conclude two things. One, that in nickel that the hydrogen would want to sit at the O site, and I would conclude that the solubility is much lower in for hydrogen nickel, both of which happen to correspond to experiment. What do you think? What do you think? This intuition's pretty good. We're making a lot of mileage on this.
And why it is not periodic?
It is periodic. I'm just doing from one atom to the next. If I go on, I'll get it to repeat again and again and again. Okay, so nickel, similar to PdH, smaller lattice constant, minimum background electron density O site, but now a higher background electron density, lower solubility, and consistency. So we're getting some understanding. This is good. So takeaway message. Takeaway message is that embedded atom picture is giving us the notion that the hydrogen wants to see a certain electron density. It seems to be consistent with the simple molecules, seems to be consistent with the hydrides, and we can understand important properties of how the hydrides are working now from this simple point of view. Takeaway message time. Questions, thoughts, comments? You'll be tested on this at the end of the hour.
Okay, are you saying then that it's more difficult to load nickel than palladium?
Much more difficult to load nickel. You can use similar arguments for some of the other metal hydrides. You can look at gold or platinum and come to the conclusion that they're harder to load than, much harder to load than palladium.
But there may or may not be, it may or may not need as much loading.
That's another completely other issue.
Okay.
We will discuss. Yeah.
what about the yield strength for nickel compared to palladium?
My recollection is that it's sort of similar, but I have to go back and look. I'm not remembering at the moment. Actually, nickel falls apart much more easily than palladium, right?
It does.
Yeah. Okay, so we've already looked at helium. So now I want to think about H2 and D2. And the place I want to start is I want to... years and years and years ago, there was an argument as to whether H2 could bond as a spherical H2 unit chemically. So for example, in the case of a rare gas atom, here's argon, and H2 can get close to argon, but that's a van der Waals attraction. So van der Waals attraction means dipole-dipole interaction at long range, repulsion at short range, and the distance, the separation is 3 plus 3.5 plus angstroms, which is, they're very far apart. Argon's much smaller than that. So we know that H2 can bond with a rare gas through van der Waals. Sort of chemisorption type of weak van der Waals bonding. But the question is can you have H2 bond with palladium or with any other metal as a molecule? Now, before 1980, the answer in chemistry was no. You go look at the textbooks and say, hydrogen bonds as hydrogen atoms. Hydrogen molecule does not bond as a molecule. And in the early 1980s, physical chemists by the name of Greg Kubas at Los Alamos had the brainstorm that, why not? Yeah, how do we know? So quantum chemistry calculations were done on different systems, palladium hydride, palladium D2 or palladium H2 being one of the first examples. And what was found from calculation was that H2 had a good chance of bonding as an H2 molecule with palladium. And this is called a sigma-bonded dihydrogen complex, which, like I say, for most of the last century was thought to be impossible. But both calculationally and experimentally, it's found to be the ground state, which is really interesting and relevant to our discussion here. Now, normally you think of the antenna here. If you have H2O, you've got oxygen, you've got hydrogen here at wide angles. That can also occur. That's a little bit higher energy than for this configuration. So what we're interested in now is, think about it as in terms of the embedding energy type of picture. So this is a plot of embedding energy for H2. So there's different curves here. The way to understand it is this curve right here, the first curve, is for molecular H2 as a molecule, keeping the distance between the two H's the same. And this curve is almost indistinguishable from the same curve for helium-4, for very good atomic physics reasons. Now, suppose you say that if I put it in Joulium, maybe the distance will change some. So here's the curve for having the distance be twice as far away as for the molecule. And D equals infinity is basically saying they're far away, they're two hydrogen atoms. So you get basically twice the hydrogen embedding energy curve. So that's sort of the way to look at this. So if you think about it, at low electron concentration, the molecule wants to be a molecule, and it's got its equilibrium distance. At high concentration, the two atoms want to be far apart because they're happy being by themselves. But in the intermediate range, you have a place, for example, here, where you've got the molecule with some separation here as being lower than the molecule equilibrium separation, but it's higher energy than having them be separated. So if you looked at this curve alone, what you would conclude is that you'd never get the molecule a little bit larger radius next to an atom. But this does include polarization. You have dipole-dipole attraction that adds some energy and can give you some binding energy that can make up the difference between the two curves. So the way I'm thinking about H2 or D2 next to palladium is I'm sort of thinking of the embedded atom picture. If the electron density is too low, you just got a molecule, nothing special. If the electron density is too high, you got atoms. But if you're in a particular electron density regime, reasonably low electron density regime, you've got the possibility of having the molecule, as long as you're something polarizable, hanging together like a molecule with a little bit larger separation. And that's what it is that is going on here. You've got the right electron density where you've got the thing happy being a molecule, and then you've got some polarizability with the palladium, weak polarization, which is giving you some traction. So in the case of molecular PD, here's our friend Bela Subramanian, again using his relativistic analysis. And here's the minimum for the molecular PD H2. And this is at small angle, which basically means that this thing's behaving like a palladium atom and H2 molecule interacting as a molecule. And like I say, this is part of the field of sigma bonded dihydrates and so forth. It's one of something in the neighborhood of 150 to 200 systems known that work this way. The potential curve in a quantum calculation is like this. There's separation at large distance. If you bring the molecule close to the palladium, you get some attraction. There's a mean separation here we'll come back to. You get binding energy. The mean separation was 1.67 angstroms between a palladium and a hydrogen. The HH separation is 0.81 angstroms, which is a little bit bigger than 0.74 of the vacuum molecule. Here's a van der Waals type picture. So here's the 1.67 separation number. The binding energy in this calculation is about 0.7 volts, but the literature doesn't have agreement on what the binding energy is here. We get numbers between 0.22 volts, 0.76 volts, and basically simple density functional calculations get 0.25 to 0.3 volts. The ones that are high, some of the ones, this one I think is a very sophisticated quantum chemistry calculation that has very high order interactions. This hasn't been resolved from experiment. It would be nice if it were resolved because then we could understand how things work. Okay, so now, so for PDH2, it's no longer just a question of the electron density, although the electron density tells most of the story. It's electron density plus dipole-dipole interaction. So the basic idea is that we can get some intuition making use of both of those pictures. Now, while we're talking about nickel hydrogen, let's think about it sort of the same way. So the ground state of nickel is a triplet state. And a hydrogen molecule coming to nickel staying in the triplet state, well, the hydrogen goes into the triplet state, so it gets anti-bonding. So the minimum energy, the ground state of nickel hydrogen 2, it's basically almost a linear molecule. It's got a little bit of a bend to it. On the other hand, the second excited state configuration of atomic nickel is a singlet state. And a singlet state of nickel behaves a little bit like the singlet state of the D10 inner core of a palladium. So you actually get the bent equilibrium configuration, which is the kid sister of the palladium molecule. Here you get nickel molecule. Molecules get a little bit bigger separation. But the same basic thing happens on the excited states of nickel. So nickel in this regard is one of the closer analogs of palladium. It's different, but and the difference has to do with the ground state of palladium being spherically symmetric, or being a singlet, and the third excited state of nickel is where you see the singlet, which is why the ground state's linear in the molecule. Okay, takeaway message. Takeaway message is basically we're beginning to understand how to think about the molecule, the H2 molecule and palladium. The molecule is happy being a molecule near palladium, which is really cool, which means if you want a molecule in palladium deuteride, having palladium there is not a bad thing. In the case of nickel, nickel's sort of a little bit like palladium in that respect, which is encouraging. Let me pause for a moment and catch my breath. I'm presuming that I've lost everybody by now. I've got everybody nearly asleep. You can't be a successful professor unless you have the power to induce deep sleep into everything within the sound of your voice. Okay, so now let's take all of this intuition and come back to palladium hydride and palladium deuteride. So there's no preferred electron density from the embedded atom business, because when the H2 or D2 has the equilibrium separation, you just get a straight line, and you only get the curves when you get different separations, larger separations, but they lie higher over in the low electron density regime than the molecule. So the potential minimum, we're thinking now in a boneheaded point of view, comes as a balance between dipole-dipole attraction and embedding energy repulsion. So the question is what electron densities are the relevant electron densities? How do we think about it? Where should we look in the lattice to see if the molecule can form? So the place to start is go back to the PdH2 molecule, go to the equilibrium separation and say, well, what's the electron density? What electron density does Mother Nature like as exemplified by the PdH2 molecule? There it is, 0.033 electrons per angstrom, per cubic angstrom. Scratch my head. Well, that's like a factor of 2 lower electron density than where the proton wanted to sit, a little bit more than a factor of 2 lower electron density. Let's go back to PdD. Here's the background electron density. That number was, in these calculations, 0.079. My conclusion, no way a molecule is going to form in PdD. That the electron density is too high for the molecule to form. The electron is too high. Antibonding orbitals are going to be occupied. It's going to push itself apart. You're done. So we're done. Palladium deuterite, my conclusion from this, is not a host for a D2 molecule. Period. Can't form. And that's consistent with the early literature in 1989, 1990, that people analyzed this and came to a similar conclusion. On the other hand, let me complete this. So we're not going to get D2 in palladium deuterite because the electron density is too high. Let me pause. Okay, so now let me think about the basic problem is that if I want to make a molecule, I got to lower the electron density. How do I lower the electron density? Well, let me take out one of the palladium atoms. Let me make a vacancy. So the problem, as we said before, had to do with antibonding orbitals. If I go back to H2, the singlet state with the bonding orbital, so the sigma orbitals, you know, one s electron is near one proton, one s electrons around the other proton, they're in phase, so we get a bonding orbital. This gives us a binding curve that looks like this. In the antibonding state, one's this way, one's this way, there's a node here, there's energy required for the node, that gives us the triplet state, it's antibonding. So if you have high electron density, this guy gets filled, you start filling up the antibonding state, it pushes the hydrogens apart. That's why the molecule falls apart at high electron density. So we want to lower the electron density. This is, Christensen and others were big critics of cold fusion in 1989. So once again, I apologize for using their work to help clarify the issues. This is a calculation of H2/D2 in Jovian. And this is the separation. This is the binding energy as a function of separation. Basically, at 0.063 electrons per cubic angstrom, you basically, that's sort of the threshold where the thing falls apart. At higher electron densities than this, you have no possibility of even having a molecule even at twice the separation. Okay, so what I want to do is I want to take one of the palladiums away. So this is sort of shifted up one level by what we've looked for before. The palladium that should be in the middle, I've taken it out. And when I'm using PowerPoint, I show the grid and then I click on it and it goes poof and it's gone. So imagine that we've poofed and gotten rid of the palladium in the middle. So what I want to do is I want to sketch between, well, I want to go in the 1-1-1 direction kind of again. I'd like to sort of look at it the way I was looking at it before, if possible. And here's what it looks like. So before we came down, TO came back up. But instead of going back up, this palladium is now gone. So instead of a palladium here, there's a V here, and V means vacancy here. So we see electron density is lower here, and the electron density that the H2 liked in PdH2 was 0.033. We got electron density of 0.033 here. So we actually have the possibility of now having conditions where the molecule has a possibility of forming. And in my view, I think that's a big deal. The point is that by simple superposition model, we can get electron density down to where we need. And there's some literature on H2 formation near a vacancy, and the results here are consistent with the literature. So I can look at the electron density around the vacancy. There are O sites. There's an O site here. There's an O site here in the different directions. So you can see that the hydrogen, if you have a vacancy, the hydrogen actually wants to sit at the electron density that it likes the best, which is our 0.069 number. And the 0.069 number ends up showing up basically pretty close to the O sites near the vacancies. There's a little bit of a shift in the calculations, but basically things don't move very much. So here's one such result, 2009 calculation from Russia. Here's the O site, and according to their calculation, a couple of tenths of an angstrom, the in towards the vacancy is where the equilibrium position of the hydrogen would be. Now, other calculations give numbers that have less of a shift. Basically, what this is saying is that these ideas in these models are consistent with very sophisticated density functional calculations. The boneheaded picture, which we're getting so much mileage out of, actually is backed up by much more extensive calculations. So we have a picture then that O site shifted with a vacancy. If we go a little bit further, we get down to electron density where the D2 could sit. So the question is can we go ahead and start modeling that? So a colleague of mine, Louis Ducharo, used quantum espresso, which is a density functional model, to calculate this particular case. And what he found is that the binding energy of the D2 molecule near the O site is minimum. The separation, this is basically 0.74 angstroms, which is the equilibrium separation. It starts to fall apart a little bit, so it goes up over an angstrom. But then there's a caging effect, and so it's a minimum in this calculation. It's a little bit over one angstrom apart. Basically, the argument is from this calculation is that density functional calculation supporting the notion that we're making a molecule in the mono vacancy. From the literature, we know that that can only happen if all the other O sites are occupied. So the result is intriguing. It's suggesting that mono vacancy can host a molecule under certain conditions. There's literature on the interaction of molecular hydrogen with the palladium surface. This is one example. Here's a molecule coming down from the surface in this direction. And as you come down, this is the DD separation. This is 0.74, so you've got your vacuum molecule here. As you approach the surface, the thing separates, and you get individual atoms. These are calculations showing what happens when a molecule comes in and goes into palladium. There's a little bit of a barrier, and then the energy goes down and goes in. In that particular field, there's been a recent claim that if you have palladium hydride, that a H2 binds to the surface of palladium hydride. There's a site that's been found where the molecule is binding very much like what was just discussed for the vacancy. The only difference is that this has got experimental and theoretical support, that the binding energy is, so recall, around 270 millivolts. Yeah, 270 millivolt binding energy. So from my point of view, this is the closest analog of the proposed D2 state. And I'm guessing that the binding energy, if you have a vacancy, is going to be not too terribly different from that 270 millivolt number. Now, the binding energy from Lou's calculation was much more than the 270 millivolt number. And when I went back to look at Lou's calculations, the polarization of the palladium was larger than I would have expected. I made up a toy model involving just polarization and embedding energy. And this would generate a curve which is a little bit closer to what I would expect to happen. So here's the molecule, the vacancy point being a molecule, but then there should be a drop of a couple hundred, maybe 200 plus millivolts, down to a point very close to the O site. And then past that, the electron density goes up and the molecule is not going to be happy. So at the moment, I have a collaborator in Colorado who's burning up lots and lots of cycles with quantum espresso and some other codes to try to do a better density functional calculation of this system. So that's in progress at the moment. Takeaway message. Takeaway message is that there looks to me to be a place for the molecule to form. You need a vacancy and you need high loading. In fact, if we use the 270 millivolt number, the loading that you need to make the molecule is not too terribly far from 0.85. Below that, you don't make the molecule. And above that, you get more molecules. And if the excess heat's proportional number of the molecules, then the loading curve and the excess heat curve would have something to do with one another.
Go ahead.
Yeah. There. So this is a calculation we published a while back showing under these conditions that if you basically that the occupation of the molecule near the monovacancies, you get nothing below 0.8, around 0.85, you start to pick up occupation of the molecular system in palladium deuterium. So that the thinking is that when you made your monovacancies, that the observed excess power is a function of loading curve, but the reason that looks that way is the formation of the D2 molecule near the vacancies. Okay, let me pause for questions. Are there questions?
So I have a sense there that the D2 was around the vacancies, and yet we're looking at the high loading code, it's not looking at how many vacancies there are in the palladium, so it's wondering how that relates.
The issue is, in my view, has to do with making the vacancies. Making vacancies is a highly non-trivial thing to do. The thought is the following, that vacancy formation energy is near electron volt in palladium, which is why it's hard to make a vacancy. But the vacancies are stabilized at high loading, roughly 2/10 of a volt per hydrogen nearby. And what that means is that at sufficiently high loading, the vacancies become thermodynamically preferred. I have a model for this that by now is out of date. This was done in 1996 or so. There's better thermodynamic data, so I have to remake this. But the basic idea is that here's temperature. Room temperature is around here. So if you're near room temperature, if you're loading about 0.95, you've stabilized the vacancies such that the vacancies are thermodynamically preferred. And this effect was noticed by Fukai, a very famous hydrogen, Japanese hydrogen and metals guy, who thought that. So here's palladium deuteride. If you heat it up, as Fukai did, he had a diamond anvil cell, high loading, raise the temperature and let it sit there for hours, and did X-ray spectroscopy on it and found that he removed 1/4 of all the palladium sites for vacancies. So it's called superabundant vacancies. So this is an experimental realization of this effect. And while I was making up these view graphs, the neat thing about giving a class is that every time you go over the class again and again, you see new things. And I have something new here that is retrospectively obvious. But Fukai published a paper showing thermal desorption from nickel made with high pressure with the superabundant vacancies. And so you get a desorption peak at low temperature, which is due to the octahedral site nickel coming out. And then you get two peaks associated with the vacancies. I'm not 100% sure I know what these peaks are. I'm kind of thinking that this might be the octahedral site near the vacancy, and this might be the tetrahedral site near the vacancy, but I'm not sure. But what he did is he took some electrodeposited nickel that had been around for 32 years, and he did some thermal desorption spectroscopy on it. And you know, because it's been sitting around, there's no occupation of the oocytes. But the vacancies that were produced by electrodeposition remain, and thermal desorption, the two peaks are showing up at basically the same temperatures as for the superabundant vacancy phase. What that means is we now have a diagnostic, and again, kicking myself because, you know, this should have been obvious for the past decade or more, but we can now measure the vacancies quantitatively. So, for example, in a Schwach co-deposition, a Letts co-deposition experiment, I'm going to try to finish up, and I apologize profusely to Nickel, to Mitchell for this. In 1989-1990, Schwach carried out some co-deposition experiments. The idea is that if you co-deposit the palladium, maybe you make vacancies, maybe it helps things. So he saw excess heat turn on, so this is 0-60 minutes, excess heat turned on half an hour. Now you remember me talking about Fleischmann needing a month, 2 months before the onsets of excess heat, SRI, you know, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks before excess heat, 30 minutes. So in Schwach's protocol was people tried to reproduce Schwach's protocol afterwards, and largely didn't have success. Cravens had no success, Letts had no success, and others had trouble with it. When Letts was thinking about his failed experiment, he said, well, what would Peter say? Peter would say, well, you need high current density so you have high loading during your co-deposition. So he cranked the current density up over the Pambos's protocol, which was a low current density co-deposition. And Pambos works at low current density because if you load high current density, the palladium falls off, it's flaky. So Dennis cranked up the current density, his palladium didn't stick, it fell off. And he said, what are we going to do about that? I know, let's reduce the co-deposition rate by having there be less palladium and electron. So he did that. As soon as he did that, co-deposition excess heat. So it's reproducible in Letts's hands. Mel Miles tried out Letts's protocol, saw the biggest excess heat he's ever seen from co-deposition, which sort of supports the notion that co-deposition at high current density means co-deposition at high loading. Vacancies are stabilized, you get superabundant vacancies. Superabundant vacancies, the molecules form. Molecules form being available for making excess heat. And so this experiment, under this interpretation, is supporting the notion that molecular D2 formation of vacancies is what's important here. And this is turning on very quickly. To do Mitchell honor, Mitchell was one of the first to pioneer co-deposition for excess heat back in 1989. Okay, I've gone on way too late. Let me entertain questions.
I see some researchers use electron beams and also baking to prepare before loading or at the same time as loading. Is that to make the vacancies?
Mitchell and I tried to make vacancies with electron beam irradiation. The idea is you can make Frankel vacancies, which in my view are much better than the larger vacancies from ion bombardment. But a headache is, it's practical. If you start out with metal, you can make lots of vacancies, but they anneal relatively quickly to the saturation density, about 0.15% vacancies, which is nowhere near enough to play these games. What you really want to do is you want to load the palladium and the nickel up to very high loading to stabilize the vacancies. Then you want to use your electron irradiation, which is problematic because the electron radiation heats it up, which makes the hydrogen deuterium come out. So it's difficult to do, but that would be a good way to do it. But in my view, in the existence now of this new LETS protocol, we can co-deposit and make vacancies now as we like. And this is sort of much simpler technically than using irradiation. The thing that hasn't been done is to correlate the number of vacancies with the LETS protocol and correlate that with heat, because now we can measure the vacancies. Sadly, there are no resources to do any of this work at all, so it's nice having these ideas. It's a little bit too late in the game.
Okay. How can measure the number of vacancies?
Thermal distortion, the signal. The strength of the signal will give you the number. The strength of the distortion signal is going to be proportional to how much hydrogen is in those vacancies, which under controlled conditions can be proportional to the number of vacancies. Anyway, I'm stopping for the day. Bio break time will resume in 11 minutes.
Okay. I'll review what we did yesterday. Yesterday we talked about the materials. We talked about the application of applied electric field intensity to materials. We talked about ways that we measure both in terms of a transconduction response and a dielectric response. We talked about the ways that these materials respond, especially water, because that's going to play a big role in this. And then I briefly went over how we infer from a measurement of temperature power, because you really don't want to just look at thermometry. What you want to do is turn it into power spectroscopy so you can compare different things. So today, what I'll do is we'll talk about aqueous systems. We did this yesterday with the calibration, so we'll talk about aqueous systems, excess heat production. Then we'll talk about some near-infrared emission experiments, and then finally our preliminary work in trying to make electricity out of this and various propulsion devices. We'll talk about some nickel and palladium systems, aqueous, and the most important thing for me is I'll show the impact of flux equations, how that for me, in order to get cold fusion to work, I actually had to do the opposite of what everybody else does. People term cold fusion as fusion by electrolysis. And I'll show you that what we discovered in March 89 was when you work the equations out, electrolysis quenches the reaction. So it's really 1 minus electrolysis. And that is the worst possible thing you can do. And that led us to the role of flux and the metamaterials, which are the fusors. We'll talk about that. We're going to skip the things in green. Then we'll talk about heat after death and the emissions. Okay, so first is the observations of excess power, and by integrating over time, looking at the energy in these cold fusion systems. And basically what I'll show you is we're using palladium with heavy water here, and nickel with ordinary water, and then I do, in some experiments, additional doping with heavy water. We've been through the definitions yesterday. Let's just go back over this. This is simple thermometry, where what we do is we take the equivalent of a current source that's sort of a battery with a resistor, and what we do is we put it across either the cold fusion system, which in this case is platinum is the anode, palladium as the cathode, and heavy water in between with no additional ions. And here, over time, several hours, and here we're looking at the temperature, and as we slowly put in power, the temperature's rising, and so here's the control, and we're putting in more power here than here, but we're getting a lower temperature. So this is not a good way of determining how much energy we're getting out, but we can see that there's an incremental energy out compared to the OMA control.
So when we measure thermometry, we get temperatures in the core as high as 160 degrees C. I tend not to, with heavy water, I don't usually like to go above 100 degrees C because it's too expensive for me. But I think things are changing. We're learning how to entrap it and close it. And we're going back up to high temps. But here, I just wanted to point this out. You can make tea. There was a lot of posts yesterday about this meeting, and somebody said, well, still nobody's ever gotten a temperature to make your tea with cold fusion, and clearly that's not true. It's enough to give somebody a good burn. Now, I'm going to show you, I hope today, more curves than the rest of the community has so far put out. And we're going to do that. We're going to show you power spectroscopy curve after power spectroscopy curve. And hopefully by the end of this hour and a half, you'll be able to tell quickly if a system is really delivering excess energy or not on the basis of how this works. So for example here, we're looking at log power between 10 milliwatts and 10 watts. Here we're looking at time from 0 to 40 hours. And what I usually do is an initial measurement where we're looking at the noise of the system. That's the noise of our calorimeter, power supplies. We measure it down here. This is less than 100 milliwatts. Usually, with enough time, we can get the noise down in the range of 10 milliwatts or less. And so here, we want to drive it. As I showed you yesterday, you want to put the input power above the noise level. So here, we're putting in this input power in blue, and we're getting out the red, and that's the Ohmic control. Then we switch to the nickel system. This is a nickel ordinary water system with no additional salts in it. And here is the input power to the nickel cathode, platinum. I think this one uses platinum. Yeah, no, this is using gold. Forgive me, gold as the anode. That's why I showed you both gold and platinum yesterday. Sometimes we switch from one to the other. And here's the output. So here we're getting more out than we get in at each of the input power levels. What we also do to make sure we're not being fooled is we do time integration. So here we see the time energy curves. The Ohmic control here, these two match. And that's what we always see. We see either a linear or a quadratic rise, but these two will be matched. And here, when we're putting it into the cold fusion cell, we begin to see a separation. If we were doing a single current, this would be a linear rise for the background. We're seeing it coming up here, increasing, and here it's even a higher rise because we're increasing the input power, okay? Go ahead.
Was this after a specific loading profile?
Yes, okay. Yes. Most of my runs, what we do is we'll load over a long period of time very slowly, and then when we do a demo or we do the experiment, we'll run it. And you'll still see a small amount of time where it has to reload. I mean, it doesn't come down to zero. There's some remnant protium or deuterium in it, and then we have to go back up and hit the activation energy. Now, here's another one. This, the last one was nickel gold. Here we have, this is a nickel with ordinary water and a platinum anode. But again, it's the same similar graph. And what we see here is from 0 to 15 hours. Here we see the power level. This is a tenth of a milliwatt up to 10 watts. We measure the noise in the background. Here we go to the Ohmic control. There's three Ohmic controls here we put in. And here's the input to the Ohmic control. Here's the output. We get a little bit less out than we put in. But when we switch to the cold fusion system, we're getting more out than we put in. More out than we put in. And with the Ohmic controls, less. So here we see two graphs of nickel systems, one with a gold anode, one with a platinum anode, and this clear excess heat. And we've calibrated against an Ohmic control, as I showed you yesterday. And here we see the energy curves, which you read over here. This is in thousands of joules. Okay, the loading of these things is only hundreds of joules. And we're getting a lot more out than we're putting in. And so here, the energy, this is the excess energy here, and the final excess energy of the experiment, this is the difference. Any questions?
Okay, so, if I understand that there are two wires, one is the Ohmic control that you use to calibrate the system, and the other is the nickel cathode.
There are four wires. Two of them go to an Ohmic resistor.
Yeah.
The other two wires go to a cold fusion cell, which is really next to it. Actually, the resistor is within the cold fusion cell. So So four wires come out, and we either put the source on the OMA control or on the cold fusion electrodes, and we switch back and forth. This is done mechanically.
And the power is measured by coming.
It's powered by a conventional power source. This is just a voltage source.
How's the power measured?
The power output is measured by calorimetry. The power input is measured. It's essentially a DC circuit, so we measure the voltage and the current. Okay, so let's take the input electrical power of one of these runs. So this goes from, now we're looking from 1.5 watts to 2.5 watts input power. And here we put it into the OMA control. We get this delta T out, 20 degrees. And here we put it into the fusor, the cold fusion device. And we get out a higher temperature for the same power in. We can do this. Here's from 0 to 8 watts. This is a different run, different fusor. Here we use multiple controls, three different resistors. For each one of these, we have to use a different resistor often, and for multiple reasons, as I'll explain later. The fusors and nanors change their impedance over time, and I often like to have multiple resistors inside it. That's why you're seeing some of this. And if this comes on, what you'll see is our loading. Okay, what we have here is the cathode. This is in ordinary water. Actually, this one I think is heavy water. And over there is the anode. You can't see it. So the electric field intensity is going from here to here, here to here, like that. And what's happening is, as a result of the applied electric field intensity going in that direction, the cations all go in that direction. We get a cathode fall over here, and eventually we'll be seeing bubbles appearing on one side. And what we have seen, as I'll show you the equations, what we see is when we lose the excess energy, we see bubbles everywhere. And we think this is really important when we set this up. Let me put the film up so you can see it. We have the camera down. A lot of the pictures I'll show you today are the pictures and videos are either from a visible cam that's put inside, or some of these I modified so they only pick up the infrared. And here you see the bubbles are appearing slowly on a single side. And what this indicates is actually that the deuterons are going in here, coming out the metal. I think that's the reason we're getting the excess heat, is we're producing a flux through the metal. I'll go into that in a moment. And this is a loss. I mean, when I see bubbling, I don't like it. This is 2003. I'll show you some newer ones when we go to high power, and we don't like any bubbling at all. Even though cold fusion is called fusion by electrolysis, I think it's a bad misnomer. Yeah.
So this is your spiral round wound palladium cathode. That's your fusor that we're seeing.
Correct. Well, you're seeing the base of it, not the electrode coming up.
But normal electrolysis, you should see also the evolution of hydrogen.
People in this field love to see bubbling. when I first brought, a week after Fleischmann and Pons made their announcement, I built a device that had minimal bubbling, and I took it to one of the labs around here, and I said, oh no, it's not working. But it was. It turns out what it wasn't doing was quenching the desired reactions. Let me show you one more. This is the device that we showed at the demo in Peter's office in 2003. I'll show you the data in a moment. But this is essentially low power. We're looking at 2 watts. We're looking at an energy gain of about 2.7 during that week. That's hydrogen. That's D2.
That's the D2.
Right. From the cathode, we get out the hydrogen, or D2 is a diatomic gas. At the anode, we get out oxygen as a diatomic gas. And what we often do is, when we get a new power supply, don't have to do it much anymore. But last century, One of the problems with people who get in this field is in England, in Europe, the potential is minus the voltage. So if you get a European power supply, it's not this way anymore, but last century, if you got a European power supply, what was plus is not measured plus here, it's minus. So what's always good is if you do any experiments in this field with older supplies, get some salty water in a paper cup, put in two paper clips, and the one that's bubbling twice as fast as the cathode, and label it. Wow. That's a good idea. And then you can measure the voltage, too. I mean the impedance. All right, let's show you this one. What we're looking at here, in a little bit of time, I'll be showing you the impact of co-fusion driving some Stirling engines. And so we drove those. I think we were able to semi-quantitatively measure the output up to about 25 watts. And I'll show you that data. We actually went probably close to 100 watts. But I don't publish that data because it's not as science, it's not as semi-quantitatively analyzed. And I think it's more of a qualitative estimate. Anyway, what you're looking at here is about 800 to 1,000 volts across a heavy water system. You're looking at palladium. I'm sorry the images are so bad. I can go to a different part. Maybe it'll come out better. But you are looking at minimal electrolysis, and the water is very close to boiling. And that's not the way most people do it in this field. But take your pick. It seems to work good for me. All right, let's go back to this now that you've seen those. So this is called LiFusor. We found this to be incredibly effective compared to other types of co-fusion. And let me just tell you a little bit more about what we're doing here. Is we use no additional salts. Okay, so these, an impedance of my cell might be 800,000 ohms. Nobody in co-fusion has liquid systems at that impedance. And we get very high outputs. And over time, the impedance falls as contamination is a big issue. That's why I think contamination is a big issue here. Okay, let's see some more if we didn't do this. Here we're looking at excess power in watts. So this is going from 0 to 4 watts out. Excess beyond what we put in. Here are the controls. We see no excess out, which is what we would expect. And you should not believe anybody that doesn't do controls. And here we see an optimal operating point manifold. And Gail and I discovered these back in around 92, 93, 4. And then I went back and looked at the math, and it pops out of the math, out of the quasi one-dimensional model, which I'll show you in a minute. So what we see is, this is really where you want to operate your device, right? Anybody who operates it here probably won't see excess energy. Anybody who operates here won't see excess energy. And I think the two reasons that it comes down is one, we're getting wasteful electrolysis. We can call this co-fusion by electrolysis, but it's quenching it. There's just no doubt about it. And I can show you those pictures too. Okay, this is with palladium heavy water, the fusor, and that's it, is it palladium? I'm sorry, it's written wrong. And as I showed you yesterday, here we see three controls. The input is in red, the output's in blue, so it lags a bit. It matches for the controls, not so much here because we're not able to capture all the heat that comes out. Yet the fusor itself, we're getting out 2.5 to 3 times out what we put in. And that's what we showed in Peter's office at the first open demonstration in 2003 that went for 5 days. I showed you yesterday that in addition to switching between the resistor and the co-fusion cell, sometimes we want them both to run continuously. So we'll have two identical calorimeters. And that's what we have essentially here. And that's called dual ohmic control. We don't do much of that anymore. But it was helpful then because by having a single current that goes through both cells at DC, it's easy to calculate what the current is in amperes. And then we measure the voltage across each, and we can measure the delta T and easily show we get excess out. So here, for example, what we really like to do, see, here are the controls. Our input to the control is in green, the output's in blue, the input to the cold fusion cell's in purple, the output's in red. So this is our power gain. If we integrate over time, this is our power gain. There is no power gain here in the cell, in the resistor. And if we take the time integrals, which are over here, 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 and here, the Ohmic controls are here, the input and output, and the cofusion device input's here, the output's here. So this difference is the energy gain. And it works a little bit even after we shut it off. That's called heat after death. And that is this little amount that comes out here. It's a little extra boost that we get for free by having set the system up. Any questions? Okay, let's keep going. All right, Peter showed you this before. This is the demo we did over in his office. We had the camera inside. This is the actual output of the run. On the afternoon that we had several hundred people come over from ICCF10, my goal was to try and teach them about optimal operating points. So what we did is we changed the input to the cell to try and drive it from a peak output and ruin it, and that's what we did. So we were able to show that the peak gain, which was 240% that day, we were able to drive it down to 8 by raising the input power and getting more electrolysis, which is opposite what everybody wants. And it came back, and at the end of the week, we had all of these data points, and here's our optimal operating point manifold for what was in your office in 2003. And we see that we drove it between 0 and about 2 watts input power, and over here was the best place to drive it. So we try to characterize our systems so we know a little bit more about them before, so we know what to do. Here's a run that we did with Gene Malov during his murder. He was supposed to come back on Sunday, and he got murdered that Friday night. But so here are the results of that. Here the Ohmic controls are so good. Here's the power, input and output, nice match. In a really good system, you want the Ohmic controls to be in between the input and output to the cold fusion device, but it's very hard to do it all the time. But you really want to try and shoot for it. So here's our input and output energies. It's a match. Again, you want them to normally be in the middle. Here's our input energy to the cold fusion cell, and here's our output. Here's our energy gain. And that was during the run that Gene started but never got to finish. We did the demo in Peter's office in August. We kept running the cell off and on, not a continuous duty cycle. And I think Brian Josephson came by, I think it was in March or so, the next year. And what was interesting about it was the gain had fallen to 140%, down from 290. So he was very happy because he had never seen excess heat before, and I was depressed because I wanted to show him the 290. You always reminisce over your past excess energy. I mean, anyway, this was the result of the run that we did with Brian Josephson. Again, here's our input and output to the controls. Here's our input to the cold fusion device. This is energy, and our output energy, and here's the power inputs to each. And again, we see the heat after death.
Yeah, I often see the palladium works. Palladium and heavy water, and nickel is light water. And is there any why are they work better rather than nickel and deuterium?
We're going to talk about that on Friday.
Okay.
I'm sorry, we're moving so slow. But aqueous today, dry tomorrow. Various types of interactions on Thursday, and then we'll get to exactly your point on Friday. Let's go back down. So here was the run with Brian Josephson that we did, and when we plotted out in terms of an optimal operating point manifold, which is now we're looking at input power, this is up to half a watt, we see this. See, again, it tanks out. The important thing to think about cold fusion systems is it's not fusion by electrolysis. It's fusion destroyed by electrolysis. Anyway, This is a summary of our results over the years with palladium systems, with nickel systems. And the take-home point here is we do get excess energy in aqueous systems. It's beyond the latent energy within the materials themselves, and it's reproducible. As long as we're able to control the resistances and limit the contamination and ensure the loading, it's reversible and controllable. Let's go to the next one.
Question.
Please.
You mentioned contamination. Have you actually measured any in the metal after?
Yeah. It goes to the surface. It's a very bad problem. All right, flux. There are a lot of limitations with the Nernst equation. It's only good in equilibrium conditions. I don't like it anyway because it has a lot of adjustable coefficients. Basically, you take the output, you divide it by the input, and everything has an activity coefficient, and you match the curves. What's that tell you? So what I prefer is we set up a system where we look at one-dimensional flow, and it has paid off. All of these things we've learned from it, and I'll explain to you what it is right now. Flux is flow. You all know what that is, even if that doesn't work. There's different kinds of flux we're going to talk about. There's intramolecular deuteron flow. I showed you that yesterday, where we have that's the response of water to an applied electric field intensity. We have intermolecular deuteron flow. What Peter shows you as the loading, I actually interpret as one of those D transfers. And we see that as a result of an asymmetric infrared vibration and a microwave rotation, that D will actually go to the surface. But it's a small difference in modeling. Then there's fluid flows. We talked about how that can give rise to errors in flow calorimetry. There's intra-electrode deuteron flow. I think that's how we get the excess energy. I'll show you pictures of that in a minute. And then there's the palladium flux flow, which is how we end up making co-deposition layers. Let's jump ahead, loading flux. Peter already discussed that. So let's talk about it a little. If we have an anode here and we have a cathode here, we apply electric field intensity, we're going to get a flux of deuterons, J is the flow. And what I did is I've now divided up the directions of the flow within the electrode, because I think that this is important. So some of the flow of deuterons can go to a gas, and I think that's going to hurt us, because if it goes up in a gas, we're not getting loading. Not only that, if we get a pathway to gas, it's going to keep going to gas. So we actually have a way to totally shut off the desired reactions. Some of the deuterons are going to enter the metal. Some of it are going to flow through the metal and then out. That's the intra flow within the metal. And a very tiny amount, if we're successful, will go to fusion. We can call that zero, because for every joule we produce, we're only burning up 10 to the 11th deuterons. And compared to the other flows, that is going to be essentially zero when we calculate it. So here's our equation. We consider at least two terms. Our total flow of deuterons has a term from the gradient. So this is minus the gradient of deuterons times the diffusivity. This is the electrophoretic mobility times the, this is minus the electric field, right? The difference in potential with respect to space, and the total concentration of deuterons. So this is the flow from the applied electric field. Yeah?
In your electrolyte. This is an electrolyte.
Yes, right? Yes, this is electrolyte.
I've been talking about it in the metal.
I know. We're gonna connect up. We will eventually connect up. Yes, this is at the surface of the metal as well too, I think. And I think this is where, when we work it out, we're going to be able to control loading. I think this is the biggest mistake made in this field in 25 years, is the chasing of gas, because it shuts off the reaction. So let's go through this for a second. We can take the flow equation, and we can divide by D, and we end up getting the first order loading rates. So the first order loading rate of entry to the metal, this is what we want, isn't it? Right? We want to get it into the metal to load, is equal to the electrophoretic mobility times the electric field. So the higher the field we put on, the more we're going to load. Sounds good. Sounds right. As well, minus what goes into fusion and minus what goes up in the air. It's a zero-sum game. We're only going to load what we don't lose to the gas. So in fact, this is the loading. It's 1 minus what goes up in the gas. It's just so obvious. Anyway, we can take around and add terms. We can put in the Einstein relation, and we see that the entry of deuterons into palladium or protium into nickel depends on the ratio of the voltage. Well, this is QV as an energy, the applied electric energy, to disorder. It's the ordering energy to the disordering energy minus what goes up in the gas. And to me, that is the first equation of cofusion. If you want to learn how to do this, you start with this. Your first order rate, what goes in, it's the applied electric field minus what goes up in the gas. And even if it's active, that's essentially zero. It's so small. Questions? Okay.
That stuff going up, the gas going up there, that's the TAFL unloading that we talked about earlier?
Yeah. And Horofsky. They're both things you don't want. You want the deuterons in the palladium. You want them as high as you can. You don't want any exit route. And I also think you don't want contamination on the surface, because otherwise it'll never load. It'll just all go up in the gas. Okay, let's go to the next one. So we take these equations. We see that thermal order and disorder, and that's our first equation. Okay. We already saw that. Sorry about that for repeating it. Happy days. Excuse me. All right, let's start over. Let's do this. Did it again? This can't be.
Go to the slide after the
video. Yeah, I'm going to erase it from the set this time, if I can get any control at all. Let's try one more time. All right, let's get rid of that. See if we got rid of the offending ones. Oh boy. It won't go. Sorry.
Maybe start past it. Yeah. Oh, it didn't delete it.
It didn't delete it? No, it didn't.
Don't go back.
It didn't delete it. All right, let's try this. Save. Now I've had it deleted, right? We'll try one more time. And I'll probably regret it.
It's cursed.
It's something. All right, I guess that's the end of that section. There's a lot of stuff there, too. I'm sorry about this.
Just don't go into the presentation, though. Just use it.
I'll try that. All right. Sorry about that. I hope it works. I think the important issue is I was going to show you a series of videos when we're getting excess energy out in an active cell, we're getting minimal bubbling. And one of the videos I'll show you, if I can, if I could have, we actually quench all of the excess energy as the bubblings come out everywhere. And it's just absolute proof that these totally quench and devastate the desired reactions. Co-deposition also has a role with the same equations. Just as before, we talked about the flow of deuterons being due to a diffusion term from the gradient and an electrophoretic term from the applied electric field intensity. The same thing's true for palladium in solution. Pd++ is a cation. It's going to go to the cathode with the applied electric field. We can write the same equations. And from that, we ended up showing that the loading ratio, here's conventional co-fusion or Fleischmann-Pons system, and here are the two types of co-deposition. And the reason there's two types is because we end up co-depositing on palladium, and at Spaywars they co-deposit on copper or nickel, and that's because we find palladium works better, but it's a little bit slower, and the flakes don't fall off there. We also have been using, this is a DAP is a dual anode fusor. So what we'll do is we'll have the fusor as a cathode. We'll have two anodes, one where we create a co-deposition layer and one where we then drive it. And the details are over here. Basically, what's really interesting is that the solution resistances are 800,000 ohms. And over time, it'll fall to 4 kilo ohms. And by then, the excess energy gain will come down to zero. So we find the contamination issue is clearly indicated by the change of resistance. We put infrared cameras inside the cells. Only when we're at the top of the optimal operating point manifold do we see infrared output.
Is the contamination external contamination from the solution that goes on to the cathode, or is it through transmutation elements? Do you know?
Yeah, we do know. It comes from the container. It comes from the solution. It comes from the electrodes. It comes from anything you wrap around it. It comes from the air. And the air thing is a real big issue. One second. One of the reasons I have trouble with some of the transmutation results is we found back at MIT in nutrition in the 70s when we were looking for mineral levels needed for animals, that unless the animals were kept in plexiglass away from the air, we were getting false numbers. We couldn't determine minimal amounts needed. So it turns out fomites from the air can change a lot of stuff, and all of those will cause a problem. Okay, so here we see the infrared. This is an optical cam near the fusor. The anode is over here in the background. You can barely see it. And when we get the excess heat, we get out a nice infrared signal. Here we see an optimal operating point manifold. This is, I'm sorry you can't read it, it's between 0 and 12 watts input power. The output goes to 3 watts excess. And what we see is with time, as we do more co-deposition, this rises. Okay? So it turns out that these other layers that we put on the surface have a big role in generating the hyperloaded requirement that's needed. So here, for example, if we calculate how many palladium atoms we're putting on the surface of the palladium, because remember, unlike Spaywars, who deposit on copper, we deposit on palladium, we see that the excess power gain goes up. Okay, let's see some more. We can skip this. CAM flux, CAM is a catastrophic active medium. One of the things I realized back in 94, actually a little bit before that, was as I told you yesterday, palladium is an M4. It holds like a vase. It holds a lot of the deuterium, but if you raise the temperature, it comes out very quickly. So by the time you go up 60 degrees C, you've lost a lot of it. And that plays a really big role because this has to go somewhere. So we did a model where here we're looking at this. This is the loading. So we're loading over time. but when the temperature starts rising up, we get a sudden deloading. And I think that's what drives these reactions, is that there is not a uniformity within the cell. And if we have an area that suddenly heats up, all those deuterons have to go somewhere. And I think they're heading to the vacancies that we're going to be talking about shortly. And I think that's where it drives it. So we have different things. We don't have time to get into this. Optimal operating point manifolds. This is really important. If you... Cofusion has always been said that it's irreproducible. It's just scattered data. Except if you take the data and you plot it as a function of input of power. And then you get a series of curves over and over. And we've seen it for heavy water, for helium production from heavy water. We've seen it for excess heat from all of these systems. I showed you one of them here. So he has an optimal operating point manifold. And these are important because often when you look as a function of input power, these are very narrow peaks. And so if you're outside the peak, it didn't work. But if you've measured the whole system, you know where to drive it. And that's why many negative results in cold fusion may be due not only to loading, but also being due to missing the optimal point. Okay. Here we're looking from input. This is log input power. These are looking at a number of experimental data. This is Spock's data on tritium from Spey Wars. This was our early data on heat production from nickel ordinary water. This is Mel Miles' data for palladium heat production and helium production and Arata's data. And I looked at that and I was just astounded because they all line up. And it was as if all of this chaotic data that people claimed was in cold fusion all of a sudden had some order. Now, I totally believe these because Spock and Miles did not publish the voltage. They only published the currents. So I asked them to go back into their notebooks and get the data to get the input power. So they didn't even know they were going to line up until after they published and then went and looked in their notebooks. So I'm sure that this overlap shows how real this is.
How much is the voltage?
Pardon?
The voltage?
This is input power.
He wants to know how much voltage.
For which? Different people use different voltages. Let me go back. When we do the nickel or the palladium, we will drive it between 50 volts and 2,000 volts. Most people in the field don't go above 10 volts. And I don't like that because then when they calculate their input power, they subtract the thermoneutral potential. So you take a small number like 3 volts, subtract off 1.5, put it in the denominator, and you already have a false gain of 2.
So why do you call the OPP manifolds?
I didn't come up with another word. You wouldn't believe what I called them before Peter changed the name, so I'm not even going to tell you. All right. We did a lot of experiments to find the form factor for this. So here... We must have taken thousands and thousands of points. This is actually how it looks for palladium. And this is looking at the excess heat, and that is the actual form factor. Okay.
What is that nanomaterial?
That's Arata's nanomaterial. We'll talk more about that tomorrow. What we can see, I think the important thing I want to show is that these optimal operating point manifolds exist. They change with time. So for example, when we're growing these, when we're loading, see here, I'm going to guess what the numbers are. I'm just going to make it up because we didn't measure. We weren't smart enough. But let's say this is 0.8, 0.9, 1. These rise. And so it would be nice to go back and to know what the loading was so we could get the idea of the height versus loading. But this is just with time we see them grow. Now, my apology to you, this is Ed Storm's data, and my apology to Ed, who doesn't believe in optimal operating points, so I had him send me my data, I had him send me his data, and by gosh, when I plotted his input power there at the optimum operating point manifolds, and he said, we're there. And here is his unloaded sample. Here was his on day four, day five. So even though he didn't see it, there in the data was the same thing that we had discovered. And that is a good way to control it. We see it with co-deposition. There's the rise again. This shouldn't be here, but the reason that we don't like nickel is when you add deuterium to nickel, it seems to damage it. Okay, you get away with it with palladium, and you don't get away with it with nickel. Here was what I did at ICCF9 was I added small amounts of heavy water to the operating ordinary water system. And as we increased, I'll go over this on Friday, as we increased the amount of deuterium in the ordinary water, we got more excess out, but after a certain, here's 14% D2O added. So here our power gain's 2. But what's really interesting is we changed the nickel. It changes, it becomes dark, its electrical properties change, and every one of these never again showed excess heat. We could use them as a cold control. Okay? Another thing about optimal operating point manifolds is where you normally run them may not be the same place you want to drive them if you have a motor. When we put on Stirling engines, as I'll show you later today, we were astonished to see that there are 2 operating points, and a lot yet has to be learned about where to drive these systems, and they don't appear to be the same. All right, we talked about that. What, are we going the wrong way? Whole piece, incredibly useful. These are out of order. All right, here's the Stirling engines. We'll talk more about those in a bit. What we do is dual calorimeters. So one calorimeter will be down here with a ohmic resistor. Another one will be here with the co-fusion device. These are in electrical series, just like I showed you before. And we'll have 2 Stirling engines on each. And you'll see one of them is flying around, the other one just isn't even moving. We start both. You have to start Stirling engines. And here's the optimal operating point manifold for the Stirling engines. We had a peak at 5 watts power input, but we went over 20 watts. And actually, we went to 100. I showed you some of the pictures. Take-home points. Optimal operating point manifolds explain a lot of data that if you don't look at it through input power, they just seem all over the place. But if you look at it through input power, they align. And they get rid of the irreproducibility myth for cold fusion. 2, by using optimal operating points, we can compare how things work. I mean, suppose I have nanomaterial 1, nanomaterial 2, and I want to compare them. If I don't measure the whole response and compare the peaks, I'm not going to get a good, accurate reading of how they compare. So I think it's crucial if we're going to evaluate configurations, systems, materials, we have to use these so we can each evaluate them at their peak. It is hyperdrive. I'm not going to get into that now. In fact, let's just go to the next one. Oh, photo activation. This is important. We're going to talk about the role of optical irradiation on the cathode. And Peter, I think, is right about his ideas. I think there's a second role. And I think what happens is that the optical radiation changes the electrical conductivity in front of the cathode. And it actually changes the loading. And we wrote a whole paper on this in 2003. I really don't want to go into it now because it's complicated. But see, here's our fusor. This is filled with heavy water. Here's an ohmic control, like a resistor to you, right? You can even read what the resistance is. And here we have the laser hitting it. We'll put in about 3 milliwatts of laser irradiation, and we'll get out about 80 to 100 milliwatts excess energy beyond what we had. Now, what's most interesting is, for me, the optical irradiation only worked when we were at the top of the optimal operating point manifold. And we see that a lot. The application of applied magnetic field intensity, the application of incident light, for me, only has worked when we're at the top. And we'll show you some of that data later. This is all from the advanced equipment. This is CoFusion 101. We can't go into all of this. You'll be here for 2 weeks. All right, let's go to the next one.
Question on OPP. I've seen some of your experiments where you raise the current, get gets the optimal operating point and then it falls off.
Yeah.
Have you ever run fusors or nanoars at the optimal operating point for a long period of time?
Oh, yeah.
At that spot? And when you do that, do they degrade faster as far as losing performance faster when running at OPP versus other levels? Or
good questions. Darn good questions. First of all, when you see the these generation of optimal operating point manifolds, we run our system, we call that in exploration mode. Jeff named this stuff. And I think he's absolutely correct. So what we try to do is explore the response of the system. Then we go into exploitation mode, which is what you're talking about, where we try for long periods of time. And both the fusor and the nanner have, you'll see, they go for months. Now, we do see a fall off of gain for a number of reasons that I'll show you. But we have found their performance has actually been pretty good. All right, let's go to metamaterials. I hope this one works better than before. Okay. We tried all kinds of stuff. I tried wire electrodes, foil electrodes, woven electrodes, graphite, nickel. I mean, we went through everything. And something really worked well. And that was this wound configuration when we had a solution with no additional electrolytes. I'll break this taking off by itself. That was this. So we had a gain of not much. I mean, it's funny. By the time we did the demo in 2003, these numbers, we would call them, we would ignore them. And now, when we see the levels we saw in 2003, we don't pay much attention. But I think the important issue is when we wound it, all of a sudden it stuck out from all the other data. We call that the fusor. And what's interesting about this, I think this is a metamaterial. Metamaterial is a configuration of a material object where its characteristics change. We're very used to characterizing materials by their dielectric constant, their index of refraction, all kinds of things. Turns out, shape plays a role. Now, nobody knew about this before, and this came out with optical devices where some people created negative refractive index materials and all these other things. And we started looking at these wound cathodes, and they're very interesting because the solution has a very high electrical resistance. The electrode itself has a very small resistance. We were measuring all of this. And we decided to do an analysis. And this will go through it for you. And basically what we discovered was what we think is the second problem with cold fusion, which is most people, when they set up cold fusion, set it up in an equilibrium way where they get no flux. So let's look at this. Here are an anode and a cathode. These are the electric fields between the two. And in fact, we get symmetry. We end up getting where there is no net flow through the metal. It's all coming in all directions. And that was different from what we did. When we did this wound system, it turns out that you end up getting flow through the metal. And that's very different from having the two wires. And I think that also plays a role. So two-wire configuration, stability. Here we end up getting a flow through the metal.
These are simulations, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. You know, we've thought about how to do it electrically. I've looked at dyes. If we had enough funding, there's so much stuff we could do, but it's just hard enough. Anyway, I guess.
No, in the old days, you know, I'm an old-timer. We used to put a probe into the bath, if you will, and then you basically trace the equal potentials. And that was very long and arduous work.
It is. Yeah. And today, like I say, you have dyes that can change color in the field. Right. So hopefully by next year or sometime we'll have some pictures. Gotcha. Okay, so the electric field distribution. The important thing is that with the high impedance solution, with the coil, the electric field distribution appears to be very different. Now, what happens is if we add salt, we shut off the excess heat. And all of a sudden we get a gout of, this is from the advanced stuff, But essentially what happens is I showed you that when we get the excess heat, it comes out one side, we can ruin it. We can shut off the heat by changing the salt. And as a, by the way, I showed you when we were getting the excess heat in this same picture, right? We can put that back on or when I'm done with this section. And what you see is minimal bubbling coming out, and it looks like it's boiling just about near the surface. All right. Take home messages. Shake may change metallurgy, even though we don't think about it usually. It appears that the fusor, the wound coil in a high impedance solution may cause intrapalladial flux, which may play a role. And these are the papers if you want to read them. Yeah.
Is it possible that it was the process of bending the material around that kind of stretched the outside of the
crystal? Absolutely. Absolutely. It could be an element of cold working as well. Absolutely. In fact, that was our first hypothesis in the paper. But, talk about heat after death.
Sorry, but metamaterials, how do you create such material? Because normally are augmented structures of different materials.
Metamaterial is just the shape. So you make the material and you have to make it in a certain shape.
Metamaterials in the literature refer to very specific things. You're using the notion of a much more generalized sense.
Okay.
He means spiral cathode.
I'm talking about, I use the word metamaterial to mean that the shape may change what the material normally does. So here, when we use them as wires, we saw one effect, and we make them into, we see a different effect. That's all I mean. All right, heat after death. Probably one of the worst names ever given to anything. I call it tardive thermal power because it comes after we put on the input. Tardive means it's delayed. And if we do a time integral of the tardive thermal power, we get heat after death. That's obviously the energy involved. Heat after death, tardive thermal power is the apparent excess heat that keeps coming off after we put in. You can't really talk about an energy gain because you're not putting anything in. It would be infinite. But here we can see it. Here we have the dual calorimeters. Here's the input to the fusor. Here's the output. So here's our excess energy. We shut off the system here, and we find, voila, even though the input is stopped, the output keeps coming out, and this is heat after death.
I think I've asked you this before, if you go back to the prior slide, but with heat after death, is there any indication or any data that you have that if you drive the device for a second, or 2 seconds, or 5 seconds, versus 100 seconds, whether you get the same heat after death as a result?
Good question. Yeah, that's in the advanced course. I'll show you some of that.
Because if you did that, you would have higher gains. If you drove
yes,
for a second,
you
got a minute of heat after death versus the gains would just start moving up.
Absolutely, and you can use heat after death here. Is this the one where we did heat? Here also is heat after death. See, here's the noise level. Here, this is a beautiful run because here's the input, here's the output, and aroma control, we did a nice match right in the middle. You want the match in the middle. And here we can see the heat after death here. And here, where do we do the power? Here we took the heat after death and actually did work from it. We put it through a resistor and heated up a second container of water. So as far as I know, this is the first time we took soul energy from heat after death and used it for work. But what we've also done, I'm skipping ahead here, I apologize, is the fall off of excess heat appears to have different components. I'm not going to get into it now, but it appears I can do a lump parameter analysis of what's going on based on those. This is what you're talking about, Steve. If we end up driving in an active region, pulse, 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 we can actually get a lot of power out here. So we don't know the optimal drive, which is what you're talking about.
How long does it take you to go from no reaction to maybe not your peak reaction, or to your peak reaction, or to a reasonable reaction output? You know, is it is it a minute? Is it
when we drive the systems in the beginning, we don't get excess energy. We have to load them. So are you counting that initial loading? Because that may be a week or two.
Say in the middle somewhere, you know, right in the middle there. You've already
this comes up fast. We don't let them come down too far here. Obviously, by the way, if you dragged out the heat after death time, right, you'd take longer to go back up.
But when they're falling down and you decide to apply energy again or power again, how long does it take to rise up to near the top of the slope?
Well, here it is right here.
Is that just like it?
So we're looking at, this is minutes. So here we're looking at something like 20 minutes.
But that's your calorimeter relaxation.
Yeah, that's a good point, right. That too, yeah.
So it might be faster.
There are many ways that we can control heat after death. We've got to talk about that in a different course. But, okay, let's go to the next one. Any questions? Pardon? How late do you want to go? Okay. We'll give you a break at the end of whenever you want. I mean, if you get tired, I'll quit. I can keep going.
I'm
going
to have to go. Should shoot for 2 o'clock, probably.
Till when? 3?
2 o'clock, probably.
Oh, right. Wrong clock. I'm looking at fake data. All right. Well, let's just talk about the near IR emissions.
Yeah.
I'll just show you what some of these look like. We got into this initially because Spock at SparWars had published these infrared pictures, and I wasn't convinced they'd show excess heat. They show heat, but there was no proof they're excess heat. Okay? And I wanted proof of excess heat. So our goal was to try and expand on what they did, build a custom system with infrared measuring. And boy, was I shocked. It turns out that to do it right, you need multiple controls. You need 2 sets of controls. We weren't even close in the beginning to realizing what we needed. Here was the fusor that we used. We used the gold anode there. In order to do the imaging and do the calibrations, we take multiple films over long periods of time. Then we end up being able to measure output. By the way, we do measure right over the ohmic resistor. I put 2 solar cells, one over the ohmic resistor and one over the nanor. I mean, I don't know how linear the whole conversion is to go through the monitor, but to zero with order, we were able to do the following. Here are the images. Off, off, on. And then when we look here, what we're looking at is temperature. So here is our fusor, here is our ohmic control, and what we did, it turned out there was an engine nearby. We had the Stirling engines, I'll show you that in a second. And when we look at the infrared coming off, which I assume is roughly what we're picking up with the solar cells, over the monitor, by having photographed in the infrared, this is what we picked up during the excess heat run over the cathode, and this is what we picked up over the ohmic control at the same amount of heating. Actually, this is hotter than here. That's why I said I thought it was initially the non-thermal, but we'll see what it is. In terms of the excess energy, we got 80 times out what we put in. We also were measuring input heat flow. These are nickel, ordinary light water systems showing near infrared when you're at the top of the optimal operating point. More of them. I don't want to get into this right now. I think this is the important point here. In order to do infrared work, you need multiple controls. You've got to do not only your ohmic controls, but you must do a measurement control of background, ohmic control, and the device. And so I was astonished at how many controls we needed to pull it off. But on the other hand, we did have one more method of seeing what's going on with the excess heat. I'll just show this briefly. I went through the Navy's book on radiation sources, and when you look at Bremsstrahlung, this is the equation, and I plugged in the numbers, and my gosh, I was astounded. The amount of forward radiation that you expect is so temperature dependent that when you go to room temperature, you have a drop off of 18 orders of magnitude. So to me, the Huizenga fake thing about the people being dead, I'm not sure that's true for the Bremsstrahlung at room temperature, because what we see is the output frequency falls to the infrared, the intensity falls by 18 orders of magnitude, and I think it's skin depth locked inside the metal, but we'll see. Questions? We'll go to the, yeah.
In other slides, I saw most of the input to output were like 2 to 4x, but you mentioned there was one 80x.
It was, yeah.
Is that in the same kind of measure, like input to output?
No, that was a small, that was a low power one.
Okay, so low input.
When we go to higher power, we get lower energy gain than when we go to high power. It may be that there's a maximum amount we can get out of these devices, and that when we go to put in more, we actually get a fall off. That's what we're looking at now. I think for any component that you make, there may be a maximum drive that you can get out.
Okay. I was talking about the Bremsstrahlung radiation is due to, let's say, normally related to X-ray generation for beam of electrons against the So in this case, is due to the could be high, very high potential.
No, Mitchell, he wants to know. Normally, for Bremsstrahlung emission, you have fast electrons which generate your Bremsstrahlung. So he wants to know where your fast electrons are and how your Bremsstrahlung ideas come about.
I'm going to leave that for you. I don't have a good answer for that, so I'm just going to put it off for now. I'm just an experimentalist. When I do theoretician, I'll leave it for Peter. I'm going to only show two more segments because we're running out of time. I know you're getting bored. I'll show the work we did on propulsion, some of it. I'll show what we did on making electricity. And we'll see how far we get. All right, this is a co-fusion motor systems. We've driven them actually by three metals. We've used nickel ordinary water, we've used palladium and heavy water, and we actually have done titanium too. And we've not published that yet. This is Stirling, that's one of the Stirling engines that we use. As I said, what we often do is we'll use two calorimeters, one beside each other, we'll put them in electrical series. And if I'm lucky, which is hard to believe,
you're not lucky.
We'll get something to work. This is the first day we got it to work. I think the first one we did, we only had one going. We don't have the calibration up yet.
Stirling engine.
It's down running
today
down here.
It is December 20th, 2004. It is 3 in the afternoon.
How was it?
Monday.
Say? Okay, so now we'll go to the next one. I think this one, no,
so what we just saw, that was running with the excess heat?
Yes, it was, but it was not calibrated. I'll show you that now.
Okay.
With the calibrated ones, for example, we were getting energy gains of 1.7, 1.5 is power in, power out. And typically, here are our results here. Up to 23 watts, and we actually went higher than that. I think we went up to 90. It was going so well that the Stirling engine, I thought it was going to go flying off. And it doesn't have wings on it. I mean, it just rotates, but the thing was shaking. So we didn't go up higher. But in the first run we did, we had more power going to the Ohmic control, and yet it wouldn't turn at all, and we got the equivalent of some number of miles. I mean, it doesn't mean anything, because we don't know what the traction is. But here was our optimal operating point manifold. And what we did actually was pretty good calorimetry. We looked at the delta T at the core. We looked at the heat flow up to the engine. We did I showed you the calorimetry with the time integration. We also did delta T's at the engine. All of these showed excess heat, as I'll show you now. And then we actually, on the way up, we put it through thermoelectrics and measured the electricity. I sent this into the patent office as a way to prove to the patent examiner that cold fusion was real, because we were able to demonstrate four ways of showing excess heat, plus a motor, plus electricity. And they pulled the papers out, which is it. Anyway, so here's one of our runs. This is four ways of confirmation. So what we're doing is trying to, we're showing gain by delta T, gain by heat flow, gain by delta T at the engine, and then we do the calorimetry. We like to find as many ways of corroborating excess heat as we can. So for example, here we're looking at the input power normalized temperatures. The fusor is doing better. Here we look at the full calorimetry. There's a nice match to the OMA controls. Here's our excess energy coming out, a little bit of heat after death. That was four ways of confirmation. And we did another group, more controls.
So using the Stirling engine, would it be a better demo rather than having one that didn't run, didn't reach a threshold to run, and you have one running, have one running at, let's say, 100 RPM and the other one running at 400 RPM?
Is that a better
scenario for that? And then you switch the Sherwin Stirling engines on different calorimeters.
We did that.
But what he needs is a little toy nano-driven steam engine thing that just...
That's right.
All right, let's show you some more. All right, here's some more calorimetry of a different one. Now, what's interesting here is I'm going to show you how, when we turn the engine on and extract the power, we actually lose the excess energy in the core of the calorimeter, because we're taking all the energy out, all the heat out. So here we turn the engine on. Here's a different run. This is six ways, because here we're adding in electricity as well. So we got the input power, delta T. Here's our gain. Here we're looking at the heat flow. We're getting more out by heat flow. This was really cool. Here we're turning on the engine here, and it's going to be hard to explain to you, but by extracting the heat, we no longer detect excess energy at the core of the calorimeter. Makes sense, because if it's taking it out, it's not in the core. So here we lose the excess energy at the core. Instead, what we're doing is using it to run the motor. Okay, one more. We'll do electricity. Questions?
What are your thoughts about scaling this up?
It'd be good.
That's the question.
If you wrote it, yeah. Okay, electricity. We have been making electricity with cold fusion back to 94. And I'll talk about some of the things we've done. Initially, what we tried to do was a number of these fusors and devices. We just put the thermoelectrics and turned on an LED. Okay, thermoelectric, we could put it into a fuel cell. The real need would be to do a feedback loop. So that's what we ended up trying to do, to make a break-even, self-sustaining electrical production system, because then who can argue, right?
So you're using three systems simultaneously on that chart, correct? Go back one. So you're using TE, fuel cell, and custom energy conversion simultaneously within the system?
Well, not with the LED. The LED was just this, but for this, yes, we're adding them all in. And as I'll show you, the fuel cell was a big mistake. You don't want a fuel cell. Basically, when you do the conversion, you're going to have losses, not only because the greatest efficiency you're going to get is 40-some 5%, let's say, then you've got to multiply that by Carnot efficiency. So you're getting a gain in energy conversion rate of maybe 13%, 15%. So in order to get around the loop and feedback, you're going to have an energy gain of your cold fusion device of 8, 10, okay? And what we found was it may even have to be higher, because to my astonishment, when I built the feedback loop, every darn thing was a loss. I had no idea. I mean, I knew that if I built a voltage amplifier, because what we want to do, the thermoelectrics give you a half a volt at the most, and we're driving these fusors with, let's say, 800 volts, so we've got to do a series of ramp-ups. Your first ramp-up will give you an efficiency of 97%, then you drop to 60%. What I was astounded by is every wire, every switch, everything was causing a loss, and I'll show you the results. I'll come to this in a second, too. Here are our losses. The biggest loss was the fuel cell. My hope was that we could build a device where we would create hydrogen and our D2 and O2 separated, and then put it back together and use it. Turns out that in order to make the gas and put it back, you get a 55% loss of your energy right there. Right there. So we wasted. To first raise the voltage, 4% loss. I ended up putting a light source out. We get 5% loss in the wires. It's just, it's astounding. When you really go to build it, everything's a loss. And so that's why we've been working on trying to get the energy gains higher. And that's where we are in the self-sustaining efforts.
So what's the best mechanism of the three? Is it thermoelectric still is the most?
I'll leave that to Peter. That's his forte.
Peter, what's the highest efficiencies right now in thermoelectric? Did I read there's some breakthroughs, something that you had worked on in the past coming about? Or
Kucherov had demonstrated basically 40% of the Carnot limit around 275C, which at the time was the record for solid-state thermal to electric conversion using a thermal diode. Number of publications on the associated technology.
Okay.
We should probably wrap it up.
Wrap it up? Yeah. All right, we'll skip this stuff.
Tomorrow.
Tell you what. I think some of the important data is here. I'll put the graphs out. If I went too fast, you can come take a look. Okay? And we'll call it a day.